Okay, so let's talk about screens, coaches. The way we're going to break this down is screening and moving out the ball. All right, because when we start getting to a three out flex or five out, you're going to have to understand these principles. Okay, you're going to really need to know this stuff, okay? So we're talking about screens now, okay? When it comes to the screener, can you stand over here, please, so they can pass you the ball? He's about to be the screener, all right? So once we pass the ball here, we're talking about the screener. There are one, two, three, four, five, six things that we got to get done, five things, all right? One, he's got to take the proper angle, all right? And taking a proper angle off a screen, coach, means your butt is going to face where you want the shot to come from, all right? So they have to make sure that their backside faces where we want the shot. So if we're saying the shot comes here, then his backside is going to end up having to face where we want the shot to come from. So he's got to take the right angle. He has got to communicate verbally and non-verbally. All right, what is the non-verbal for a screen, gentlemen? Yes, beautiful, okay? Right here, non-verbal, all right? And he also has to talk. He's got to say screen, 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 okay? If you want to be very coachy-coachy, this hand is the one that's going to go up because that's the side Max is going to come off of. It doesn't make sense to verbalize this way, all right? So it'll always be that outside hand wherever you're telling that shooter to come off of, okay? He's got to have a wide stance. He's got to sprint to screen. You cannot jog to screen. You sprint to screen, you end up getting an advantage, and then you have to screen a body and not a space. All right, he's got to hit somebody. Okay, shooter, all right? Shooter's got to set up the defender, okay? Set it up, he can run him down, all right? Or he could jog him down, he could walk him down, but he has to get below the level of the screen. All right, so if Justin was coming over here to screen, don't move anything, come right here and screen, okay? Max has to, this would be the wrong angle, that would be the right one, get here. He can't just be here, okay? What we teach our players is when somebody's about to set a screen for you, that's the most selfish time that you should be in basketball. Somebody's setting a screen for you to get open. You can't hunt shots, right? Wait, set it up, use the screen. That's your time to get open and shoot, okay? So he has to set him up. He's got to sprint off of it, all right? He's got to go shoulder to shoulder, so he's got to hit Justin's shoulder, all right? And we really like to go shoulder to hip, okay? But he's definitely got to be shoulder to shoulder, okay? He's got to be small to tall. He's got to communicate calling for the ball, all right? He has to have the proper footwork into a shot, which would be inside pivot right here. All right, it's better to be late than early. All right, you'd rather have Justin standing here saying, Max, come on, come on, come on, come on, than two ships flying, passing each other in the night. Okay, so that's pretty much basic when we're coming off a screen. Defense step off, offense step on. Take the ball real quick. Do everything. Signal, call for it, let's go. Sprint, good, comes off, shoulder to shoulder. One, two, steps up, shoots the ball, okay? Now, that's basically coming off a screen. We all understand that. There's three ways to come off a screen, coaches. All right, you can straight cut, we can curl, we can fade the screen. All right, you're going to read that at the level of the screen. All right, so this is teaching your players to understand basketball now. So what I mean by that is as he's coming here, he comes to screen, right? Right here is where he's going to read what to do because it depends on how his defender's guarding him. So at the level of the screen is where you read, okay? If somebody's coming, guard him, please. If he sets him up and Brian is taking the same path over the screen as Max, he's going to end up curling, meaning he's going to go this way, he's going to go, we're going to end up going into a curl. Go back. Hustle up. If he ends up setting him up so good, go back to setting him up. He sets him up so good that Brian gets caught up and he gets an advantage, he's going to go straight cut because he's still going this way, but there's a little bit of gap in between them. He's going to straight cut off of that. All right, if Brian wants to shoot the gap because he's been getting lit up all game and his coach is yelling at him, so he's going to go up and through, Max is still going to get his inside foot above the screen, and then he's going to fade the screen back, okay? So those are three ways that you're going to come off a screen. Now, you have to teach the screener what to do. Off the court, please. The way we like to say it is there's a bomb that's going to explode, and it's got to go two directions, okay? So off a straight cut, that means that he's going to end up slipping to the block. All right, so after you screen, he's going to go there. He comes off of him. He goes there. Right, two directions, go back. If he was to curl, he is going to roll back. Curl, boom, he rolls back that way to the ball. Two directions, right? If we go here and we fade, okay, on the fade, they're gonna end up setting two screens, right? So he's gonna come here, he's gonna set one screen this way, the second screen he's gonna face that way. That means he's just gonna go right there. All right, they went two different directions. So you have to teach the screener what to do as well because you're going to jump and go crazy when you see them overplay, but your screener doesn't slip. Okay, so defense, come on. Come on. So this is what I mean by him having to sprint. If Justin sprints, stop. That's what's going to happen. He's got to jump to the ball first on defense. He has to. If he doesn't, He's just going to drive this gap. So he has to still supply some help. All right, but now all of a sudden Tom's in a confused thing because he doesn't know what's going on. He's coming off, right? So then he might help too. He's going off that way too. He's the one that's open. But that only happens if he sprints the screen, okay? So you have to tell your screeners every single time, sprint to screen, sprint to screen, sprint to screen every single time, all right? The different types of screen coaches, you can have down screen, we can have a flex screen, we can have a back screen, you can have a flare screen, you can have a stagger screen, you can have a UCLA screen, a cross screen, a double screen, a ball screen, all right? Those are all the different type of screens. Does anybody need to see any of those screens? So if I called you out here right now to explain every one of those screen coaches, you'd have them? Ball screens, let me get to that at the end because that's going to be a very intense breakdown. Please teach your kids staggered screens because when they get to high school, they're going to run a staggered screen. Okay, so they need to know at least what a staggered screen looks like. Okay, do we need to show you what? I'll show you what a staggered screen looks like. Don't even worry about it. I got you. Peter, come here. Defense, get off. Peter, go in the corner. When he passes the ball here, Max comes here. Justin goes there. This is a staggered screen. All right? Teach them a staggered screen because every secondary fast break generally in high school is going to end up running into a staggered screen situation, okay? Your whole goal is that your players are prepared. Your son, your daughter is prepared to play high school ball. So you're doing it selfishly too, coaches. All right? Teach them so they know something when they get up to those next levels, all right? A good drill to do this on coming off of screens, all right? Give me four of you with basketballs right here. Everybody else that doesn't have basketballs, two lines over there. Or one at the top, please. Justin, your line at the top. Max, your line on 45. One of you guys here. One of your lines here. Liam, come here. One and one. All right. So the way this is going to go, we're going to go straight cuts first. Okay. So this is how the line sets up. So Justin's going to go over and screen. Okay. Way this works. This line right here will pass to the shooter. Okay. So you're going to pass to the straight cut every single time in this line. Okay, after you screen, you're gonna slip. This line has the slip every single time, okay? So that's how that would end up going. So you get multiple things accomplished at one time, okay? Let's go with that. Now, after you get your rebounds, listen, Max, you're gonna go to this line. You get your rebound, you're gonna go to this line. You go to the line that somebody passed it to you from, okay? Go, let's go. Sprint to screen, come off, slip. Good, let's go, next group up, here we go. Hustle back in line, fellas, hustle back into your lines. Good, let's go. Good, one, two, good. Every time, triple threat, good. Yes, good, hit him, let's go. So even in this drill, we're still working on passing, right? We're still making our guys pass the ball. They still have to start in triple threat every time. Every time we gotta be ready, every time it's timing, right? Stop, there we go, get here, hurry up, let's go, go, go. Let's go. Stop, stop. Now, we're gonna go into curl. So we're gonna go to a curl and a roll back on this, okay? So what that means is you will go screen for your brother. You will curl, okay? You'll curl, stop. You've got the curl, you've got the roll back. You still got the shooter. Do we understand? Do you understand? So when you ask them when they understand, they should reply, yes, coach, because they have to do that in high school. Do you understand? Beautiful. Okay, here we go. Let's go. Ready. Come on. Go. If you want them to throw a bounce pass, chest pass, it's up to you. Doesn't matter. Let's go. Good, stop. So very generically, that's screening, okay? There's not an offense that I'm believing that you guys are gonna run that doesn't have to involve screens, so you're gonna have to teach your players how to read and what to do on each screening situation. All right, and again, that's gonna plug back into your team concept, and that's gonna help you obviously understand that. Give me three lines now. Three lines, let's go. Three balls, three lines, okay? Balls in the middle. Basic kind of moving without the ball principles here. All right, there's some basic kind of concepts. You have to really teach your kids how to play without the basketball. All right, this is just going to make your lives a lot easier. This right here, coaches, turns into about 75% of high school basketball. All right, it turns in, that trickles all the way down and just gets a bigger percentage, meaning this situation. All right, Coach Andrew will be guarding him, and I'm guarding him. This situation in basketball happens about 75% of the times, and we fail miserably. All right, when he drives here, he never moves. I help, he passes, nothing got accomplished. Because we're not teaching kids how to move and play without the basketball. There's only one of them, right? So we have to know how to play without it well, okay? So in this situation, we're gonna go very slow on this, just some generics. If we're coming here this way, he's gonna go corner, okay? That's not a 10 out of 10 thing, pass the ball back. That could be a handoff if you wanted it to, all right? So you have to go either way, that's just fine, okay? If the ball ends up being here, he drives baseline, he is gonna end up going corner. Baseline drive, baseline drift, okay? Baseline drive, opposite side is gonna drift corner, okay? Strong side drive, he's gonna slide there. If Coach Andrew ends up being right here, okay, and Justin is driving at him with the ball, okay? He is gonna end up backing off the blocks, all right? And kind of going over right there. That's where he's gonna go. All right, so if he's driving at your post, your post is gonna have to separate a little bit because obviously the only person that's gonna help is Andrew's defender. Drive again. So if I am guarding Coach Andrew here, he's driving the basketball, I'm the one that's gonna help. He's gotta give some space here. So he's gonna back off there, okay? If Coach Andrew's here on the post again and you have the ball and he's driving baseline, okay? Your post is gonna shape up in the middle right there. So he's driving underneath, he's gonna pocket pass to him. All right, so you see Tom would slide, he would go there. I'm about to show you how all this plugs into your bigger schemes of offense. But again, if you don't show them these basic slides, they're not going to have a clue what to do after you run your quick hitter. And the big issue that you don't want, and you know that you have not taught them basketball, is if after you run your play, they do this. Set up. You didn't teach them how to play basketball. Because they should just be able to flow right into the next thing, into the next thing, into the next thing. So after your quick hitter, hey, I want the shot from here, doesn't work, then they should know that I passed the ball here, I go screen there, I read the screen there, I curled that, I came back, I ripped back, he shaped up, I got the shot. You should never have to call setup, right? You should never have to do that unless you're into 10 seconds left in a game and you have to really get a good quick hitter. If you've really taught them how to play basketball, and that's the whole thing that we get in trouble with, all right, because Coach Cal came in and really popularized this whole read and react, and I'm all for it, no doubt about it. You have to know what to read, though, and what to react to. So you have to teach them these slides and where to go, okay? So please understand this one more time. You just be the shooter the whole time. Just be the shooter. If Justin's driving this way, Coach Andrew's going there, okay? That's one option, all right? Go back. If Coach Andrew catches the ball on the 45 and drives baseline, all right, Tom's got to get to the corner. That's the other slide, okay? If Justin has the ball and Coach Andrew's on the block, okay, he's driving at him, he's gonna end up spacing back. Now, he's gotta watch that shooter, right, so he can't go crazy. All right, he's just gotta come get to the baseline, all right? If he ends up, Justin has the ball at the 45, all right, and he drives this way, your post should end up shaping up this way. We should end up having a pocket pass, okay? If, all right, Justin has the ball at the top, and Coach Andrew's in the corner, if he drives left and jump stops, he's gonna reverse out, he's gotta lift. So the whole thing about moving without the ball is you gotta stay in the ball handler's vision, all right? And you just have to teach your kids where to move, where to go, they just can't stand still, all right? You've gotta teach them where to go. You can break that down into any of these drills, which we're about to do right now, okay? So the first one we're going, fellas, is pass, screen away, catch above the three, rip back, drive and kick. All right, now this involves screening, this involves communicating, this involves passing. This is what I'm saying, you have to get a lot accomplished in every single drill. This should then plug into your translation portion, because this is what your beginning of your practice probably should kind of start looking like. Then when you get into translation, you should be able to take this into having five people on the court. V cut and let's go. There, call for it, sprint to screen, good, comes off, rip back, two dribbles, pass, good. Next group, let's go, go. Good. Good, let's go, get into a line. Good, two, pass it back, shot, let's go. So we're teaching spacing here, everything's outside the three. We're never playing inside the 3-point line, All right, they're driving to the second hash. Let's go, go. Good. Hold the ball, stop. Now, on average, right, these guys are doing fine, okay? But this isn't good enough, right? They're not sprinting the screen. They're not talking loud enough. They're not setting up the screen. It's not body to body. They're not ripping the ball fast enough. So this is what I'm saying, where you have to hold your players accountable. You got to tell them, hey, guys, you can go faster than that. I suggest you start moving quicker than this. Now, I want three people, put your ball down, please, because we shouldn't have four basketballs. You should be in this line. Now, you need to sprint on everything that you're doing. All right, now we should see a dramatic increase in their performance. Go. Sprint. Go. Move. Yes. Sprint. Rip back. Go. Next group. Go. Go. Let's go. Good. Go in. Good. Yes. Good. V cut. Let's go. Good. Moving quickly. Let's go. Good. Rip back quick. Good. Let's go. V cut. Good. Screen. Yes. Sprint. Good. Rip back. Yes. Go. Push. Good. Yes. Go. Sprint. Good, stop, stop, good. All right, Max, you're up, Justin, you're up, Liam, you're up. All right, now we'll do this one. This is just a different one. Second people in line, back all the way off. All right, he's gonna V cut here, okay? He is gonna catch the ball and rip baseline here, okay? And then he's gonna retreat, dribble out. You're gonna screen away. Now Liam is gonna run all the way across here. All right, this happens in basketball a lot. We get the ball dead in the corner, we don't know what to do. He has to come in his vision, catch the ball, rip back. All right, listen, a rip back is extremely important, coaches. You guys get kids that all of a sudden catch the ball from this side to this side and come right back right-handed. All right, they have to attack the other side of the defense. Again, this is gonna start plugging in when we start doing everything 5-on-5. All right, you'll plug in, you'll go two dribbles, you'll slide away, throw the ball over Justin, he's got the shot. We got it, here we go, let's go, quickly. Yes, sprint, 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 good, rip back, good. Let's go, go, good, shoot it. Come on, get out, get out, get out, get out, get out, good. Yes, rip back, good, let's go, 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 good, rip back, let's go. In, back out, quick, 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 quick. Good, rip back, go, let's go. Get all the way over there, fellas. All the way over, Peter. Don't pass it till he gets over there. Don't pass it till he gets over there. Good, there we go, let's go, 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 go. Yes, sprint, Max. Don't pass till he gets all the way over there. Good, go, push back. Yes, good. Good. Stop. I mean, it's not gonna be perfect, it's not gonna be pretty, but just having a basic general idea of like, hey, somebody comes at you, go over there. You don't have to get super, super, super detailed, just don't stand here. Go right over there when somebody's driving at you, right? That's the things that we need to start getting accomplished, okay? Because some of you guys have the same team from next year to next year to next year, and then there should be some building going on from each one. Any questions with that? Yes. I'm gonna show you when we go into five out. When we get into the five out, I'm gonna show you that. Yep. Stop, hold the balls. Everything's adjustable, and you're gonna have to adjust to your team, okay? I'm gonna give you at 10 and then you can go back down. All right, what I'm telling you is any of these drills, and this is what you have to start to recognize, coaches, that the screening drill, right? Well, when I met with Nequa's coach, that's what he handed, well, actually, it's right here. This is exactly what he handed me, okay? This is the exact drill structure that he did. It's literally says Nequa basketball, all right? When you go to college coaches, it's gonna look the exact same way. So there's not this big thing that's waiting for you at the next level. It's still always gonna be the same fundamentals. It's just the pace you do it, it's just how specific and how detailed you are when you do it, and how much does that ball go in as you're doing it. All right, but it's not gonna be like, okay, well, I was looking for this triangle offense. They're never gonna run a triangle offense. I mean, it's not gonna happen. So they still have to understand these drills that we're doing. So I'm telling you that each level they go to, they're gonna run into these same situations, okay? So again, do them a favor, help them and start introducing it to them early, Okay, so at the younger ages, yeah, you're going to have to do a lot of individual kind of skill stuff just because they're not really advanced enough to really understand some things, right? A pass, screen away is probably as far as you're going to go. But if you got that accomplished, I mean, if you got them to pass and really hit somebody on the screen and come off, that's a big deal, right? And then you just tell them, drive the basketball. That's a big deal if you can get that accomplished and put it into their heads early on, especially at those grade levels where you set a screen, everybody chases their man, nobody ends up playing help side, you're going to be open for curl after curl after curl after curl. So it was just about reading those type of things, all right? Give me one basketball, let's go. Let's go. One basketball, put your basketballs at half court. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Do you do all these drills in every one of your practices?
Not every one. We have different segments, different focuses each month. And then we'll end up working into some things.
The reason why I'm asking that is I think it would be good for the kids to be able to see in the visual aspect of what you're teaching here. That would help the coaches, at least it would help me, with driving those drills more accurately.
Online, on our website, on the Coach's Corner,
yeah.
Every one of these drills is on there. And we're breaking it down with my staff is doing it. So, but I'm explaining everything that I'm explaining here exactly on there, so those videos you guys can watch. All right, so please understand that. All right, you guys, and some of you guys have seen that on our website on the Coach's Corner. It's totally free. There's a bunch of individual drills and there's a bunch of team drills. Okay, we stop at 3-on-3. What I'm gonna go into is 5-on-5 with you guys. All right, we stop really at 3-man moving without the ball, but those basic principles are online 24/7 for you to use. Okay, when we get into defense, coaches. All right, first things first. Stand in front of them, please. Defensive stance. All right, actually, everybody get in a defensive stance. Get away from each other. Thank you. In the stance. All right, first things first, okay? We really need to understand the defensive stance, and they have to be in a defensive stance, all right? They're not allowed to not be in one, okay? They don't need to have their heads over their feet. They've got to be low. A defensive stance is just an athletic stance. The same thing that a baseball player's in, same thing as a cornerback's in, same thing. It's just an athletic stance, okay? Now, the difference with basketball, stand up, and you'll start to see these guys start bouncing and everything because their thighs are burning, which is what I want, right? Because we haven't developed these muscles enough, okay? So sometimes I'll tell them stand, sometimes they got to sit and rot in that position, but you got to start developing these muscles, okay? Stance, get down. Now, both hands up here. So if we're in a closeout situation, you will notice that both their hands are in front of their face and together. Nobody is doing the "we just scored a field goal." All right, that's not how you're going to close out on the ball. That's how you're going to get lit up. All right, you have to distract the shooter. Okay, so we'll end up teaching four windows. All right, I want stand up, stance. I want your left foot, left hand high, right hand out. Okay, so we'll have distracting the shooter, playing the passing lane. So if somebody's in triple threat, obviously we closed out, we'll come down to one hand still, guarding the shot, one hand in the passing lane, okay? Switch your hands, right hand up, left hand there. That's window number two, left hand in the passing lane, right hand taking the shooter, okay? Now I want your right hand to come down to the floor, left hand out. So now they're dribbling, okay, or they're out of triple threat. Now we've got a dig hand, we have a passing lane hand. Switch your hands. Same way. It just depends where they're dribbling, where they're going. But those are the four windows that we're going to teach, okay? Stand up. All right. I know that it was in our generation, okay? Get in a stance. Put both hands out. Both hands out. That was kind of our generation of defense, okay? I grew up getting taught this and everything. Not always the best way because of their triple threat. That's how you get super lit up, okay? So you're really going to have active hands, okay? Again, the rules that we want, stand up. Offensively is no strips, no blocks, no deflections. Defensively, we want deflections. Okay, when they start getting the high school coaches, and it's really gotten down to high school, these coaches chart deflections because that's going to tell you how active their hands are, and that's going to make it very difficult on any offense. Okay, that's why in our offensive drills, you saw them in triple threat stepping out, passing the basketball like that. So we're always going to work both sides of the ball. All right, we don't want deflections. We want to get deflections. Okay, but on just a basic defensive stance, that's really what we need to do. You can still do chop them. You can still do slides. You can do all those things. Max, step up here. If you're going to do slides, real quick, get down in the stance, okay? If he's going to go right, he's going to push off of his left foot to go that way, all right? You need to watch that they don't end up bringing their left foot to right and right foot out. Bring your left to your right. That's not what you're supposed to do, okay? That ended up taking him two steps to take what should have taken him one. All right, push. That's what we should end up doing, and slide out. Push out and slide. Go. That's where we should end up going. Do we understand? So there is some proper footwork on playing defense that they need to know. Anytime you bring this and they change directions, you're going to get put on ESPN. All right? Because you're just going to get crossed and you're going to fall. Okay? So here we go. So we're back in that. That is just basic kind of defensive stance type of situations. Okay? If we're going closeouts, give me two lines on each baseline. There we go. On each lane line. Closeout situations, there's a lot of different ways some coaches teach it, okay? We kind of stay very generic where we'll end up teaching run three, chop your feet for two, ball, 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 hands out in front of you, come into a stance. We'll always teach our players to close out short, okay? And close out short means don't close out running up, jamming up against anybody, because honestly, at all these levels, until they really get freshman, sophomore year, you don't have knockdown shooters that are just lights out, 10 out of 10 Steph Curry shooters. So for you to close out all the way up on somebody is pointless because they're not going to shoot the ball. And if they make one, they ain't going to come back and make two and three. All right? So we always teach them close out short, and then you're walking your way up. You are always one arm length away. Okay? We can't play defense like we grew up. You can't play physical in basketball anymore. All right? Everything is NBA down. All right? What happened in the NBA? They want to sell more tickets. What sells tickets? Offense. Where did that trickle to? College. Where did that go into? High school. Where's that now? Middle school. It always is NBA down, all right? So that Detroit Piston bruise them up defense, you'll never see it anymore. If you touch somebody, if you breathe on them now, it's a foul, all right? So you have to really pick and choose your times, but one arm length away is close enough. You still feel the pressure. You're not up on somebody. That is always adjustable. If somebody can't dribble, yes, take the ball from them, all right? But one arm length away means I can put my palm on your chest. You feel the pressure, active hands, life is good, all right? So you'll notice they're going to have to get closer. You're going to have to close that gap. When you guys are playing defense, let this stick out in your mind. If I'm guarding somebody at the red, this is not one arm length away. They can't feel any pressure. Then they have the object just to look and shoot and just pick us apart. All right? Get them closer to the person, but one arm length, okay? On the closeout situation, they're just going to close out to the free throw line. They're going to sprint three, chop their feet, hands up, okay? They'll say ball, ball, ball. All right? Oh, goodness, don't trip on that. Shot, shot, shot. All right? No closeout in stance. Then they'll get off, okay? Go. Sprint out. Good, leave, go, let's go, go, good, let's go. Good, leave, go, let's go. Good, go, let's go. Good, go, let's go. Good, go, let's go. Good, go, let's go. Go, let's go. Good, go, let's go. Go, let's go. Go, let's go. Stop, all right. So we'd end up doing closeouts. Okay, now a way that we would also do this drill, okay? Give me two people with the ball on this side. Give me two people with a ball on this side. Boom, yes, thank you. Shooters right there, balls underneath. Balls underneath, okay? Now this is about getting multiple things accomplished right now, right? So we're gonna get closeouts accomplished. We're gonna get shooting with pressure accomplished right now, okay? So we're gonna get passing accomplished as well. Defenders are going to pass the ball to the shooters. They're going to step in with the right footwork, shoot the ball. We want to hear nine words right now. I want to hear ball, 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 shot, 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 box, box, box. All right? You have to force them to communicate. All right? They have to communicate defensively and offensively, okay? Ball, 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 shot, 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 box, box, box. Shot goes up, we box out, then we switch lines. Let's go. 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 Good. Next group. Go. Good, go, let's go. Step up, Trent, go. Let's go. Good, go, let's go, let's go. Let's go, let's go. Stop. So my suggestion is as you progress in the season, start putting defenders in every one of your drills, all right? Like we stop doing drills on air after our first month and we start putting defenders on them every single time just so they can get used to those pressure type situations, okay? Let's go three man real quick and we'll go over shell and then we can tie this thing all together. Let me go Max on D, Justin on D, Black on D. Liam, you're on D. Red on offense. Yes, Tom, you're on offense. Thank you. All right, so the way this is going to go from a defensive side of the ball, okay? He's obviously one arm length away. He's in help. Stop, don't move. We're going to always teach one-thirds, two-thirds. All right, that's just a generic way that we teach because, again, I don't know what your philosophies are going to be. All right, some coaches will teach deny the wings. You totally can teach deny the wings if you want to. No different, nothing's wrong with that, okay? We will teach one-thirds, two-thirds, which means he's one-third away from his defender, two-thirds away from the ball with a hand in the passing lane. We'll say that there was a rope attached from this offensive players. They need to be able to touch it. So Liam will be able to grab this imaginary rope right there, so he's got a hand in the passing lane. All right, he's always kind of bottom side hip because if he gets top hip, he's going to get backdoored. Right, so he'd be in a stance, he'd be in a stance. Obviously, we'd be yelling, help, 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 ball, ball, ball. We're just going shell, you're not moving at all. All right, we're just going jump. So once the ball passed over here to Peter, okay, Justin has to jump to the ball, Max has to jump to help. Now, you'll notice Max is not sure which helpline I'm about to tell him to be on. All right, and I'm not talking any trash to him. He really doesn't, not sure which one I'm about to tell him on, okay? Because when he was younger, his helpline was there. As he's getting older, I'm pushing his helpline over there. The reason is because he's getting older. Now in high school, you can't be in the middle of the paint because you do have Josh Ruggles, Austin Park, somebody's going to knock down shooter. You can't be in the middle of the paint anymore on help. All right, but you're bigger so you can cover more ground quicker. Okay, so we'll start pushing their helpline over to 1 foot in the paint as they start progressing in our program. Okay, so after that, we pass the ball again. Nope, stay there. Pass the ball. Yes. Boom. Pass the ball over there. Yes. Everybody's on jumps. Everybody's moving. Everybody will be talking. Easy enough, right? So we're in the proper defensive position, okay? Now, if we're talking about guarding a screen, coaches, okay? There's two ways that we'll teach guarding a screen. You can tight trail it, chase it, tag it, whatever your terminology might be, or you're gonna guard it up and through, all right? It just depends on who you're guarding and who you're playing against. What that means, if we go this way, all right? If we're guarding up and through, that means we wanna leave a gap between our person that we're guarding and our teammate. So Justin will just jump and drop. As Brian's going to set the screen on Liam, stop. This gap right here is the one that Liam's going to come through, right? So every single time we'll end up playing up and through like that, okay? Play up and through a couple rounds of it. Go. Good. So he's leaving space for Max to come through. Reverse the ball. Coming this way. Coming up through. Good. Pass the ball. Close out. Hands up through. Good. He's out. Pass the ball. Come through. Stop. So that's one of the ways that we'll teach him to guard the screen, okay? We're still working on offense because we're still working on reversing the ball. We're still working on passing the ball. We won't let him steal the ball unless we're starting to play live, okay? The other way that we'll end up guarding is if we tight trail, so he passes the ball here. In a tight trail situation, coaches, it takes two people to guard a screen, not one, all right? So as he's screening, tight trail means Liam is going to take the path that Peter's taking. When we did the screens, we said when that happens, the offensive person should curl. Correct? So now he's going to have to come over here and be his little help for a second while Liam gets through, and then he's going to go back. Again, it's just about being able to teach one of those just coming through. The easiest way to teach screens at the ages that you guys have would really just be up and through. All right, because you really don't have shooters coming off that you got a tight trail. Okay, so teaching just, hey, get out the way, let that person come through. The main thing that you've got to teach is a screen is not an excuse. Okay? You don't have an excuse to not guard your person because you got screened. Get around it. That's all you have to really teach and really focus on. A screen is not an excuse. Okay, that's the main stuff we want to focus on, okay? So that's real. I'm just touching on that because now we're going to get into the fives. Does anybody have any questions with the defensive stuff? Yes. So there was a study that was done in Eastern Europe, and I'm not lying, and this is how crazy we are with basketball, okay? And it was talking about, they actually did a study on what was better in practice situations, 5-on-5 or 3-on-3, all right? And really in terms of at the younger ages, 3-on-3 was more beneficial from a conditioning standpoint and from the touching the ball standpoint. In 5-on-5, you can hide, right? You don't have to necessarily do anything. You can just be a reversal person. All right, when you start playing 3-on-3, it gets very obvious whose fault it was that didn't play defense and didn't do anything on offense. So it's important to at least have a segment in your practices of playing 2-on-2 or 3-on-3. We will build 1-on-1 up to 3-on-3. So eventually when we get to 3-on-3, we really don't play a lot of 1-on-1 anymore. Okay, but it's important to play that because then I'm teaching every one of them to do something when they have the ball. I'm encouraging them to be active when they have the ball. Go impact the game. Go use one of those moves. Go make a mistake. We have never yelled at any one of our players for making a mistake. All right, we've yelled at them for not focusing. We yelled at them for their pace. They make a mistake because they're trying to do something. That's what they're here for. All right, so it is important to just get one segment in of 3-on-3 a day, because you can work on offense and defense. All right, you can work on drive and kick. You can work on that mentality. You can work on a lot of things out of it, and they have to touch the ball. Okay? Does that answer that? Does that address that? Anything else? Yes, sir. I do not. The reason I don't is because I'm not their coach. That's not a wrong thing to teach, right? It's just because I'm not their coach, so we don't teach them how to switch, because we're just giving them really a broad stroke of generic kind of basketball, all right? At the younger ages, switching, you just have to make sure it's not a scapegoat, right? Just the same thing as zone, right? We kind of use zone as just a way to lean on it because they're not really good at man. We'll make them good at man, right? There's nothing wrong with teaching switching after they learn how to guard that screen first. There's nothing wrong with that at all. I mean, you're definitely going to do it in basketball 100%. Any other questions with the defensive end? All right, let's get into transition, okay? We're going to get into transition. What we do in transition, okay? Does anybody or can anybody tell me the difference between a fast break and a secondary break? Have we heard secondary break before? Do we know fast? What's the difference? Fast break. If you don't talk, coaches, parents won't talk. Players won't talk. What's the fact? Absolutely. 100%. Really, the easiest way that we define it is that you're completely correct. Fast breaks is a number advantage, right? Secondary break is when you don't have a numbers advantage. Really, it's going to end up being one, two, or three passes, really three passes, where you end up don't have a numbers advantage anymore. So it has to flow into really a secondary break, which is really a quick hitter, which would flow into your offense. Okay, so that's mainly the difference on it, all right? So we will go, and please take these rules down for fast breaks, okay? Because when we get into this transition drill, you're going to understand this. All right, let me have you, and you. Give me the seventh graders. Yes, everybody else get your basketballs and be off the court. Liam, step off for this. Get all the basketballs, get them off the court. Hustle up. Let's go. Hustle up. Thank you. All right, so we're just going to give generic numbers here, okay? And again, for us, we always have them play different positions. We'll give them a number, and that's what they have to play, because if Max is a point guard, right, raise your hand, the thing that's going to make him a great point guard is really understanding what the post does. You know, a great way to understand what the post is to play that position, and it's not going to hurt you for 5 minutes that you played the post in a game, all right? So we really want to teach them the whole thing about basketball, right? So let's just say you were the five, you were the four, you were the two, you were the three, you were the one, okay? All right, basic kind of basketball stuff here, all right? We're catching every outlet pass. Max, catch the outlet pass. Free throw lane extended. Free throw lane extended. And you want to have your butt to the baseline. Outside the three, I'm sorry, butt to the sideline. That's where he wants to be, point guards catching the outlet pass, right? Twos and threes, we all know that they're interchangeable lanes. They can run. They need to be hard, wide, okay, and fast. So we always say by half court, your foot needs to get out of bounds. Your outside foot should be out of bounds. That should be the angle that you're taking, okay? So twos and threes go, doesn't matter which ones. Boom, they're running their lanes. We got it. Now, whoever doesn't have the rebound, if Justin got the rebound, then Brian turns into the rim runner, okay? So we'll play fours and fives, they're interchangeable, rim runner. All right, your lane ends up being straight down the middle of the basketball hoop, and you're sprinting. That's your first thing, that's your first look, okay, is the rim runner, all right? So when we get the outlet, obviously now Justin's going to end up turning into the trailer, okay? His looks first, point guard, first thing, your first look is the rim runner, all right? The first thing you're trying to do is get that person out sprinting everybody, hit the big dunk, we're done, okay? Next look, sideline, ball side, sideline. All right, third look, we're going to end up bending the ball, and we would go weak side, sideline. If nothing happens, we're just going to take it up. We got to choose a side, okay? Then we're going to end up having that basic fast break kind of principles, okay? You will see our guys, Peter right now, Tom right now, they will end up hitting the corners. All right, whenever we do kind of fast break drills, we always tell them get to the corners. All right, because you will see kids a lot of the times catch the ball on the 45, take one dribble and pick it up. It's not doing anything for you. We want to space the court like crazy. We can always lift you back out of the corner, but we will tell them sprint. If you don't get the ball to 45, hit the corners, because that makes us have way more spacing. All right, so we start to try to teach them more kind of high school philosophies once they start getting here. All right, if we were running into just a basic kind of secondary, we would dribble the ball up here. You would trail. Rim runner is going to empty out ball side. right there. So immediately if Tom pulled, pass the ball to Tom, post Brian, you got to pass, you got to dive, life is good, right? So then Justin would dive to the rim, boom, you see Peter's going to lift, boom, we're all good. Those type of movements should happen, but again, because they know how to move without the ball, this starts to make a little bit more sense to them. Do it again. So in this situation, if Max advanced to Tom, Tom gave it to Brian, stop. He dove, but he didn't get it. It doesn't matter because he turned out middle, and now he's got to lift and stay in his vision, stay there, and then he's open now. Do we understand? So it's all going to be that movement. Now, if he has the ball here, okay, back to the original spots. If we reverse through the four, obviously Peter's going to have to lift now, okay? He lifts up to the 45, we'll stagger away. Brian will follow the ball, we'll set a stagger screen away. Now, again, it comes to screening principles here, right? Stop. If Justin Mann was to help, right, Tom would go, he would slip. Max would just come out, all right? All this stuff makes a lot more sense to them because they understand our screening principles, right? So then when we're explaining it in a 5-on-0 situation, 5-on-5 situation, they have something to draw back on, okay? That's why I'm saying we had to build it up how we had to do, because now it makes sense to them, okay? So we'd end up getting to a basic stagger. That could flow into any one of your offenses, okay? But that is just a basic kind of secondary break. When it comes to things, coaches, and I'm going to do on this one, let's go all the way back here. Everybody go here in three lines on a baseline, three basketballs. Hustle up. This is my favor to high school coaches, and you guys are going to all roll your eyes at this. But I'm telling you right now, a lot of everybody, not you, does not teach this correctly. It's a three-man weave, okay? But you don't teach it correctly, and it ends up killing the kids when they get to high school, all right? We will start our three-man weave allowing this ball handler to take one dribble in advance. The reason three-man weave is important, all right, because it always comes back to fundamentals. You're going to have to pass, catch, and you're going to have to make a layup. Team USA does three-man weave. So while everybody starts to feel like they're too good for drills, I don't understand. Team USA does three-man weave, and you know what? They have to get disciplined every time they bobble the ball, all right, or they don't catch the ball. Then it's push-ups or something like that they have to do, because it's all about catching and passing on time. Your players are going to have to learn how to pass off the dribble, pass off the catch, all right? The catch and chuck, please tell them to stop doing that. It's never going to work in basketball. So you're going to have to teach them how to advance the ball. All right, give me the ball. This is the catch and chuck. I dribble the ball here. That's not going to work in basketball. All right, they're going to have to learn how to catch the basketball, take two steps, pass. They're going to have to learn how to run through their pass, okay? That's what the three-man weave should be able to teach them. It teaches you to run your lanes wide. It teaches you to communicate, whatever you want to do, okay? But we have to start understanding how to teach this properly. And what this means is he's got the ball. Liam, you would be, let's just say we're coming right, all right? What Liam has to do is get up and over, okay? So he's not just going to run up. Tom has to tuck it and run and get to half court by then because he's running on a slant, all right? The reason I'm telling you this is, coaches, is go to your practice and run three-man weave and watch everybody just run straight. It makes the passes too long. It's not realistic, right? And you're not helping them do anything because it's just a pointless drill then. Right, we have to make this make sense for the players because we should be able to go three passes and a layup. I do it with 4 fifth graders, right? They got a sprint, okay, but 4 fifth graders should be able to get up the court on a middle school size court. They do it at IBA, right? Three passes and a layup. You can do a bounce pass for the last layup if you like to. I like to just do chest passes. That's up to you, right? There's no wrong or right in that type of situation. Do a three-man weave, tuck it and run. Now, we'll do all type of competitions with it. You got to make 20 in 2 minutes, whatever it's going to be, but we're teaching them to catch the ball, pass the ball, run, sprint. All right, watch, go. So that just lowered, that's how it should look. We shouldn't be running lanes straight here. We have to start running. This second passer has to run a slant. This person has to run an up and out. It's really like kind of football, right? Go, do it again, go. Sprint. Good. Now, you'll notice Brian kind of didn't take an extra step to pass there. It throws off the whole drill on spacing. That's what I'm saying. Like, you have to be that anal about teaching it because they have to understand shortening the distance of passes, really getting the ball to somebody. We'll tell them every single time, hit them in the 14. All right, they have to get honed in on these fundamentals. Do it again, go. So then they have to learn how to sprint. Now, there's different variations of things you can go into where you can flow into something, into something, into something, okay? So we end up doing two passes right now into a driving kick. All right, so what that will mean is that he will take the dribble and he will advance to Liam. He's gonna advance to Tom. Tom's gonna take off dribbling right. Max is running straight corner for the shot. So Tom ends up taking two dribbles, he'll get there, and then we'll shoot, come back, hustle up. So there's different variations of things you can do when we start getting into transition. All right, but it's about advancing the ball and getting it up there. Play fast, coach, that's more fun. Play fast, go, let's go. Push, push, take off, Tom. Go, next group, go. Good, go, next group, go. Good, so we'll end up doing that, okay? Stop. We will do 3-on-2, all right? Give me 2 on defense, hustle up. Now you can start this out of a 5-man weave, or you could just go 3-on-2. Right, or you could go 2-man back. It's always about reading the advantage. In 2 passes, they gotta get a shot off, right? It's gotta be 1, second pass, they gotta have a shot off, okay? Go, let's go, dribbling up. Push it, go. Good. We might allow that one, right? We understand the defense is tandem, 3 on offense, go back, hustle up. Stop. So we're gonna have who's taking first pass. So we'll tell bottom guy take first pass, right? So if he advances the ball over here, we're coming here. Now, what's he in? He's in a closeout situation. So I'll see we went over closeout, so that should be right, okay? Hey, we're gonna tell Brian to hold there. He's gotta make something happen with the ball. We don't want him to take one dribble and just pick it up. We want him to make something happen with the ball, or he's gotta get it out of his hands. You got 2 seconds to make a decision, right? Either go or pass the ball back, okay? Obviously, Max gonna have to zone off because he's got 2. Okay, this is normally how the 3-on-2, 2-on-1, if you were going back, is played, all right? Go back, I'm gonna show you how we play it now. And we'll have him start here and him start here, okay? We will tell the ball handler to go, back off, all right? Once we tell the ball handler to go, we're telling them to go down and sprint, because then we can start seeing if you really got your shot off in 2 passes or not, right? Because you have defense coming down, all right? They have to end up getting it. Now, we'll always go red versus black, whatever we're doing, but this really teaches them, hey, you gotta do something in transition because defense is coming backwards, okay? For this sake, I'm gonna say go, and everybody's gonna go because you guys are a mile and a half away, all right? Back up a little bit because this just doesn't make it that much fair. You 3 are trying to score, you guys are on defense, all right? Go, let's go, 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 Trent. Let's go, give it up. Yes, stop. So we see that? This is a true fast break now. So now we can start hammering on, hey, you got to get the ball out your hands. Hey, you got to catch the ball quicker. Hey, this is more game simulated. All right, when you start moving up and they've learned some things, make your drills more game simulated. Now, let's go do it again. Same way. So Max is really fast. So I'm going to tell him to slow down. All right. Defense, I will tell you when to go. Okay? I will tell you when to go, defense. Offense, go. Defense, go. Good. Which happens in a real game, right? So we gotta make real decisions, right? So now Peter's gonna believe me when I say, hey, that's not gonna work in the game. But when you don't have extra people out here for them to see it, they'll never believe you. But now all of a sudden, now we're gonna do it again, and hey, he's gonna have to make a different decision, right? But now we have it on possessions. So we're gonna end up going, red has 5 possessions, black has 5 possessions. Whoever scores the most is the winner. There's a winner and a loser. Push-ups for the losers, right? Let's go back, do it again, one more time. So again, it ends up being into competition. Yes, sir.
Teach your point guard to not give up the ball until he gets to the top of the key.
No, we really teach him one dribble, get the ball out your hands.
Really, okay.
Really what we're gonna say is advance the ball over half court in 1.5 seconds.
Okay.
In every guard that we've ever raised, I've always said get the ball across half court in 1.5. Either that's with the dribble or with the pass, get the ball up the court. You can always get it over and stop, but you put pressure on the defense if we really get the ball across half court quickly. All right, so we want it out their hands, right? We always go back to John Wall. He got first round, first pick, not dribbling the ball at Kentucky. That's how he got to the NBA. He didn't dribble, right? He just got the ball out of his hands every single time. All right, so advance the ball. We want to put pressure on them. When we'll start to show is defense lift up here. Defense, lift up. Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. Lift up more, lift up more, lift up more, lift up more. Right there, okay? So in this situation, what we'll start to explain to them is, why do you have to run your lanes wide? Why do you have to run them hard? Okay, if Peter jogs and you jog and you're advancing, right, and defense is going, defense is going, you'd have to go back a little bit there. But this is it. This is as far as he's gonna have to go, right? Go back again, go back again, hurry up. Everybody sprint, go. Stop. That just made his job a lot easier because they made the defense go. It's all about stretching the D, right? So your lane runners have to run hard because the defense has to sink more, which makes it easier for your point guard or who's ever dribbling the ball to see what to do, right? If everybody's jammed up here, it's hard to make a decision. It's hard to run a fast break. But if we get the ball across half court quickly, it stretches the defense out immensely. All right, so it's all about pace. Get the ball up the court. Get the ball out your hands. All right, so we'll just tell them get the ball up the court any way possible, right? We'll teach them to bend the ball. We'll teach them to cut it and keep going. We'll teach them a lot of different ways to do that stuff. Let's do this one more time, and then we're going to get into some other stuff. Let's go. Hustle up. Doing the same thing. I'll tell you when to go. Thank you, Mr. Rivera. Go. Go. So we can be sure that, hey, that's a stop and pop. Shoot the ball. Cool. We have no problem with that, all right? We'll teach them to be aggressive, drive to the rim, those type of situations, all right? I want you to partner up, one ball on the right, one ball on the left. Let's go. I'm sorry, no balls on the left. Hustle up. Hustle up. Partner up, doesn't matter who. Get one ball between two. Let's go. One ball between two. If you seem to be struggling with the passing off the dribble thing, all right, and they're not really understanding getting the ball, taking two steps and passing the basketball, break down to this drill. I want you on the block. Actually, I want you right here on the elbow. All right, you're going to take, just back off, Tom. You're going to take one dribble. You're going to advance the ball to Justin. Justin, you're going to dribble. You're going to shoot. You're going to stay there. You're just going to be in a sprint. All right, so this is you're just going to sprint down, and you're going to stop and pop. You're going to dribble. You're going to pass it off the bounce to him. Okay, go. 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 So I guess here's my point to you, right? Basketball is very simple. Don't make it complex, all right? You have to learn how to pass the ball off the bounce, get the ball out your hands, catch the ball, dribble the ball, don't travel, shoot the ball. All right, we saw this exact situation in 3-on-2. So if they're having trouble advancing the ball, just break down to a simple drill like this, all right? Now, we will go back here. Let's go, hustle up, hustle up. Justin and Max up. Justin and Max are up. Justin, you're on defense. Max, you're on offense. And you see everybody take a real big deep breath because they know what's coming, right? So we'll play zigzag. Now, our zigzag is a lot different than most people's zigzags, right? Our zigzag, we expect a bloodbath, okay? Because all I want to get accomplished is mentality. That's it. I will start to teach them how to play defense if you get beat, but we want to get up, pressure the basketball, and handle pressure, okay? That's a big thing that we're not good at out here is handling pressure. Because we always go to a zone. We don't ever put the kids in pressure situations. Make them have to handle pressure. So Justin will start with the ball. He'll shove it in Max's chest. And when he's ready to go, now we're playing. Everybody else back off. And now there are no rules. Get the ball up the court is the only rule. If the ball is on the ground and you don't dive on it, well, that's going to be a problem for everybody. So we're teaching mentality right now, right? It's fun for them. They get excited. But it also teaches, if Justin keeps on stealing the ball from Max, I will not pull Max out the drill and I will keep Justin on him. You have to figure it out, kid, right? Now you're gonna have to watch so you don't lose them, okay? Because some of them get embarrassed and all these other types. But hey, man, this is what it is, it's basketball. We can't sub out because you're getting killed. You just have to step up, kid. Like, we have to start teaching them what it is to be a basketball player. Now, match them up appropriately so that really doesn't happen that much, okay? But if the ball gets taken from them, shove it right back to you. If he runs right by you, hey, you're going to get up and have to do it again. It's basketball. We have to create this mentality in the players, okay? And that's going to translate over into your team. Go. Check up. Good luck. Yep. Let's go. Let's go. Yep. So we'll end up playing just to the free throw line, right? Now, that's one variation that we'll do that's just all about hard nose going, okay? The other way that we will end up going, you two go, everybody's not going to go. What we're going to end up teaching really is the ball handler. You need to get some contact. Then you need to back off and get some space. All right. Defender, if you get beat, you end up running a button hook. All right. And putting your chest back in front of somebody. All right. Meaning if Max is dribbling left very slowly and Justin right now is beat, he's not running to his body. He's going to sprint ahead of him and he's going to run a button hook and then put his chest back in front of him. So we'll start going over those principles as well, all right? So we'll play it a lot of different ways. Some of it's just hard nose. We want them to beat the heck out of each other. The other ways that we'll do it, we'll really start teaching them, hey, one arm length away, make them change four times. Offensively, they should change two times. All right, we'll do all these different type of things, okay? But again, it's all about a mentality. It's all about handling some pressure, okay? There's no point, coaches, after they're done dribbling by themselves, you're gonna have to put somebody in front of them, and you're gonna have to deal with the fact that they're gonna lose the ball. But then you can help them learn how not to lose the ball, and that's going to translate over once again into the game, okay? So that's the stuff that we'll do pretty much in transition. Now, we'll have, let's go five black across the free throw line. Andrew, you'll have to join in on this black. Andrew, you be the black. Stop, Trent, go back there. Nope, how about this? Trent, you stay. Max, you go there. Max, you switch red. Switch red, silver. Nope, Tom, you're fine. Stay red. So this is called North Carolina Fast Break. I'm sure most of you guys have seen it. It starts to address a lot of other things. Max, give me the ball, please. So you end up having five across and five across, okay? You give everybody a number, so you'd say one, two, three, four, five. That's their same numbers as well, right? So what number are you? Beautiful. You? Beautiful. No, you're not. Why would you be four? Okay, thank you. Okay. Which one are you? Three. So then who would you be, Trent?
Two.
Beautiful. Four, okay? So the way it works, coach stands behind him, and all you end up doing is this and saying one. Stop. 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 So whoever I call has to go touch the baseline, and then obviously we have a numbers advantage, okay? And then we're playing out of that. We're working defense where we're talking about communication. We're working offense, score on a numbers advantage, okay? It ends up being 5-on-4. All right, you can end up doing it red versus black, blue versus gold, whatever it might be, okay? Two. Stop. So we'll end up doing things like that, right? So it's North Carolina Fast Break. It's a fun drill. Again, that ends up being in the competitive section. So if you ended up doing shell, working on screens, whatever you were doing, boom. Turn into something that's competition and really hone in on what you're trying to get accomplished with it, right? But that's a fun little transition drill that we will always do with them, okay? Does anybody have any questions with that? Because we're going to go right on time, and I like that. Any questions with that? Because we're going to have to go over three out, two in, flex, five out. We're going to give you some sideline out of bounds, baseline out of bounds. Any questions over anything that we've done? We're good? Okay, do you guys need water? Of course, go get water, hurry up. Hustle up. With the half court offense, again, it's all about what happens after your quick hitter. Okay, so we start to confuse terms sometimes in basketball. We're like, well, we're running an offense. That sort of doesn't exist, that just means you have the ball. What are you doing? Are you doing a zone? Or I'm sorry, are you doing a motion? Do you have a quick hitter that runs into your motion? What is it that you're doing on offense? What is your play? Okay, because a play has to go into something else. All right, let's go. I only need one ball. I only need one ball. I only need one ball. Max out here. Give me seven graders out here. Give me seven graders out here. Offense. Yes, Tom, you're on. Peter, you can be on. Liam, step off. All right, so if we're talking about a five out, okay, we're just a basic kind of five out and what we'll do. Okay, we'll end up going corners, 45, top. All right, very simple way to do it. Everybody starts on down screens, all right? He ends up picking a side to pass the ball to, okay? He screens away. He comes up, he gets the ball out of his hands, then he goes and screens, all right? He reverses the ball, he goes to screen, all right? So he's coming off. Reverse the ball, he's gonna be there. Screen, let's go, pick it up, go, move, quick, go, let's go, move, quick, move, let's go, quick. Move the ball, quick, go, quick, move, yes, go, quick, move, quickly, move the ball, go, move, yes, quick, quick, go, go, quick, go, quick, go, move, quick, go, stop. That's a basic kind of five out that we'll teach them, okay? Now, where you start to be able to plug in different little tricks, okay, ends up being in these situations. Let's just say this, and we'll see how this flows into different stuff, right? We all started with screens. Stop. So at this very moment, Brian could curl, right? And then what would that mean that you would do? You'd have to come back. Now, right now while Brian's right there, he's going to have a look. You don't get the ball. Where do you think you're going to go? Why are you going to go there? Yes, because there's two people over there, so we have to understand balance, right? So this is what I'm telling you guys. If he knows floor spacing and he understands balance, then I don't have to tell him anything. If you want to curl it, curl it. I already taught you how to read it, so curl it. You're already going to know where it goes. If he missed it, fine, I'll yell at Tom, but he passes the ball, he's already in the spacing, and we're already in offense. We're okay. We cut my job in half, right? Because I already taught him and took the time in screening and moving without the ball on what to do. Now when we go into the bigger picture, life is so much easier, okay? So I could tell him, I don't care what you do, just do something. I'll say, I want to see a curl. I want to see a drive and kick. I'll say, hey, when I yell live, somebody drive the ball and everybody else move, all right? Because that's really what's going to happen in game type of situation. So I'll give them different things, but it's not really giving them anything. I'm not going to say, hey, I want you to curl, and then I want you to drive. I'm just going to yell drive. Somebody drive and everybody else move. Let's see what happens. Here we go. Just go five out and let's just see what happens. Here we go. Go. This could be ugly. This could be pretty. I don't know. Let's see what happens. No, I don't want. Pass the ball. Let's go. Keep going. Keep playing. Keep playing. Let's go. Let's go. Keep playing. Good. Keep playing. Good. Screen. Drive. Let's go. Keep going. Keep going. Good. Drive. All right, maybe, right? And then from there, I'll just start cleaning stuff up. Like, nah, you'd be over there. Hey, you two, you should have came up here, Max. You should have went there. All right, there's just a lot of different things that we're going to do to get them start to thinking on how to implement the stuff that we're doing, okay? What was your question with on the situation? Yes. So where's everybody going to go in that situation? Gotcha. All right, so there's a couple things that'll happen, all right? First of all, what we teach in individual principles, when we're talking about driving from top attack, we always tell them drive in between the lane lines. If they drive outside the lane lines, they're not driving. You heard Coach Andrew, drive to score, drive to score, drive to score. Okay, that's what we want to do. Let me get you two on defense over here. Hustle up. Again, a lot of this is just going to depend on where the defense is at and what they're doing, okay? If Peter really does drive to score, if he kind of helps. Now, in this situation, he'd stay there. Maybe he's coming here. Okay, he's going to come all the way up for a flip out here and then attack this gap left to shoot, all right? In the same type of situation, all right? Come back. Trent, overplay him. He's driving in, and really that happens a lot. Stop. So once Brian starts seeing that his head is turned, what's Brian going to do? Right there. Boom, we back door. Once Max sees that, what are you going to do? There. Because we're just filling the spot, okay? Do that again. Just go over that one. So don't pass the ball to Brian. End up passing it to Max, let's just say. Go. So he's playing there. He back doors. He's there. That ends up happening, right? So, again, that's going to be you teaching them a back door and teaching them how to slide and then just plugging those two puzzle pieces in together, all right? But there's a lot of different things. Anything you could do, defense, step off. Stay offense, please. Offense, stay out here. Ball at the top. All right, if you wanted to say five out stagger, let's just say. Okay, well, your kids know what a stagger is, so that means he passed the ball to Justin, Peter staggers, and so does Tom. So we got a five out to a stagger screen. So really, we just ran a quick hitter out of a five out. Okay, then he pops out, nothing's there. We don't have to yell set up, pass the ball there. Then we go right back into our five out motion. Okay, if things aren't going real great and we pass the ball here, there's nothing wrong with Brian dribbling that Justin to a handoff. Cool, we got a handoff here. He turns the corner. Now we're into a drive and kick situation where they're just there and there. All these things are going to plug into one thing and one thing. Now you see why I'm saying they got to build you up and understand how to move without the ball, how to come off a screen. Now all of a sudden in your offense, it's cake, right? It's real. Now you're hard to guard. Now you're not scoutable, right? Now they understand how to play, and then if you want to draw a cook hitter out of that, life is good, okay? If we go, does anybody need to see anything out of a five out? Any questions out of a five out? The reason a five out is good is because everybody plays every position, right? That's really the main thing on why that's a good one just to do. Do what you like. Let's go three out, two in. Nothing wrong with this one because still in this kind of motion set, you still can get everybody playing every position, okay? Again, we'll play on down screens now, cool? Down screen, we come out. We pass the ball. Now there's two kind of options in this that we'll do with them, all right? Option one is we're just screening across and screening down, right? Option two, we'd end up setting cross, down, and away. We're just gonna set away and downs right now, all right? And obviously they know what I'm talking about in terminology. So go back to the start, please. So we start on down screens, pass the ball, and now we go away screens. Now as soon as, stop, as soon as Justin sets that screen and Brian's coming, he's immediately gonna go set a down screen. Boom, pass the ball, reverse the ball. Good, down screen, Peter, yes, and go set an away screen, yes. Now set a down screen, Brian, yes, boom, go, get out, Peter, good. Pass the ball, set an away screen, Tom, good. Come off, set a down screen, Tom, yes, go away, pass the ball, good, reverse the ball, here we go, move, go, go, move. Good, pass the ball, good, there we go, life is good, pass the ball, move over, good, yes, immediately going, boom. Stop, that's a lot of movement and that's hard to guard. That's a lot of movement and that's hard to guard, especially if you taught your kids how to hit somebody on the screen. All right, that's tough to guard on a high school level if you have people moving at that pace. All right, it's just a lot of movement that's going on. And again, everybody gets to play every position, so everybody's fine. Okay, now, in this type of situation, let's go again, go, go, screens. Good, yes, good, yes, good. Stop. Now, if you were to curl, if you caught the ball right there, do you see what he just immediately did? Stay there. Now, he's a guard, so I'm going to yell at him for being guardish and going corner, but he starts backing off all of a sudden because that turns into straight thing as if he was to drive there, he knows where to go. He's got an option. He's got to read off of him. Do you go high or do you go there? It just depends on playing basketball, but they know the movements to make. Okay, because we broke it down in a smaller situation. Now when we put it in a bigger one, it's a lot easier for them to understand. Okay, go again. Let's go. Go. Stop. If you drive baseline, he's going to go there. He's going to flatten out there. We're going to go right there. We know how to move without the ball. We know where to go. All right, and that's really all you want to get accomplished. So what my point is, coaches, I could run a quick hitter, and they've never heard me run this before, and I'm totally going to make it up right now. All right, here we go. I want pass the ball here. I want you to set a down screen there. Come up to the top here. Catch the ball. Stop. I want you to set a double screen. Turn, set a double screen. Run off the baseline screen. Throw the ball back to that side. Pass the ball to him. Okay, stop. Cut. Dribble. Catch. Reverse, reverse, stay, and we are back into a three out, two in. So you can run any quick hitter you want to, it's just gonna flow right back into this situation. Okay, so the stuff that we do, to answer some of your questions, we teach the end of offenses. We let you teach all the quick hitters you want. We're just gonna teach them what to do after the quick hitter doesn't work. Hey, it's gonna turn into player movement, ball movement. Somebody's gotta drive, somebody's gotta set a screen, somebody's gotta move. So come up with all the quick hitters you want. Just show how it flows back into your basic motion offense, okay? Does that make sense? All right, so if we're going on a flex, all right, you could start flex 1,000 different ways, right? You could start four low. Start back here, Brian, with the ball. Basic way, right? Brian's got to choose a side, okay? If he chooses the left side, no worries about that. He's going to pull up, all the way up, all the way up, all the way up. You're going to reverse through to him. Okay, now we got a flex screen and we got a down screen. Easiest way to get into flex. All right, if you wanted to do it out of, come back, cool, that's flex, yes, Brian, come back. Ball here, stop, come here, Justin. If we were doing it out of the fast break, all right, and you wanted your fast break to flow into flex, that's not a problem because you're already back. Gentlemen, come back a little bit more, all right? He was the trailer. You were the wing, you were the wing, you were the rim runner, right? So you ran to the rim, and then you emptied out ball side. Well, ball side is right over here, okay? We teach our guys to get to the corners. They're already in the corners. You chose that side, cool, come up, hit the trailer, boom, right into flex. So your secondary break can run right into flex, all right? If you taught them how to run a fast break and run their lanes correctly, you run that right into a flex every single time. Life is easy. All right, if you want to end up running it into a quick hitter, come here, start over. I mean, there's a close to a trillion quick hitters that you can run off of flex. Pass the ball there. You could go flex screen there, run it to a handoff. Yes, keep on running your flex screens. Good. Now, at this time, when he's driving, look who's coming off of a screen right now. Boom. Right? So you got action going on both sides of the floor. Okay? And that's really what you want to get into in the offense. You want action because you want the defense distracted on both sides of the floor. Go back into that again. Go through that slowly. So you can run anything into a handoff and then teach him to turn the corner, and then lo and behold, you're into a driving kick situation. Let's go. Catch the ball. Boom. Run into a handoff. Yes. Turn the corner. We're there. Boom. We got a shot. Okay? Beautiful. So that's how we can run flex into something. Okay? Does that make sense with the flex offense? Yep. All right. Go sideline out of bounds real quick. What we're going to do, yeah, we're going to end up giving you three sidelines, and we'll give you three baselines. One of the sidelines is going to just be a pressure release. One of the baselines is just going to be a pressure release, meaning we're not trying to score, we're just trying to get the ball in bounds, all right? The other two, we're going to do two score, okay? Bear with them. They have never gone over sideline out of bounds with us before, so this is going to be the first time they've ever been taught this.
Pressure release, correct?
Pressure release, yes, sir.
So as soon as he receives the ball, that's when you know that it starts. When those two are going to turn and face me, this is your point guard will just run off these two to catch the ball. You want to catch it on the outside, on the other side of the half court. All right, so just so you have space. All right, that'd be your pressure release. If he's denied, if it's late in the game, you know, they pressure the point guard, that's okay. Give him the ball. Come back.
Don't pass it to Tom.
Good. So as he goes through, Brian would just turn, set a screen for Krebs, come off. If he's denied, he'd just pop back to the back. So everyone's just moving. Last worst case scenario, he can just take a step into his guy and spin to the corner. So all four guys are moving.
Do it again, but nobody, don't pass the ball. Just everybody do what you have to, everybody do what he just said. So Brian, once they get by and set the screen for Peter, Justin, you get in, go to the corner.
Stop.
Stop. Coaches, that's big, though. Understand that, because your kids are going to naturally do that. They're just going to end up setting the screen right there. Don't show the defense the play. The defense. Face that way. Now, you want spacing right here, too, because you're going to have to understand that if they're not open, then we can't just run here, because then we're in a trap situation, right? We got a defender, more defenders, right? So we want to back up a little bit more. So now we have some space to operate. Okay, so we're not putting anybody in a trapping situation when they get it. All right, boom, you slap the ball, sprint, set the screen again, boom, roll back, good. There, you get all this outside, Justin, right there. So that's just, we just need to get the ball in bounds. Any questions? Show it one more time, please. Now, here's the thing. You want this person operating with all this space, right? So you don't want him curling. You don't want any of that because, again, we're in a trap situation. If we end up catching the ball here, his man's coming. You can guarantee that, or at least he should. And then we're trap, we're done, right? So you want him coming wide. You want to teach him to come catch the ball out here, come in. Heck, just throw the ball all the way over the top if we have to. Who cares? We just need to get the ball in bounds, all right? But be careful on how you teach the stuff and make sure you have enough spacing, okay? Go to the next one. End of the game scenario. End of the game, end of the quarter.
Now, a big thing with sideline is you almost always want to get the ball to the corner if you can. So a good defensive team, if they're guarding the sideline, they would put their guy not like this, jumping to guard the ball, they'd throw him here to not let the ball get to the sideline. Because if it gets to the sideline, then you're really susceptible to a lot of plays. So on the slap of the ball when he receives it, you can take one step in the defender and he can sprint to the corner. If you can throw it to the corner, we want you to throw it there every single time. So he can throw it to the corner. Okay, that's normally the point guard on the pass. You want to take one step in, and then you would just be on a dead center to them for a give and go, more or less. I ran this from college, and I actually got a game winner this play.
Where is everybody at? So this is your point guard taking this out. Your best shooter's in front. You got your three there. Now, the reason you want that, Coach, because really if you're three and we're talking about stereotypes, that's your most athletic player, right? Your three is usually your most athletic wing that you have, right? Two is your shooter, one's your point guard. You want your athlete being able to get the ball open in the wing because he can rip and go. He can do a lot of things with the basketball, right? All right. Okay. Do it. Sprint. You'd be shocked at how much that works.
4 seconds or less. I mean, that's a really good game
play. All right, so what happens next?
Option two, as soon as he breaks to the corner, as soon as he slaps the ball, your shooter is going to turn and run off this double screen all the way to the block. Okay, this is kind of a misdirection right here, just to get everyone moving. As soon as he gets to here, your two post players, which are normally stereotyped your best screeners, will turn back around, and they will come back to hunt the guy guarding the shooter for a double screen. So then he will spin off here. Here's your best shooter for a catch and shoot. Okay, so now if we think about what's the first thing you want to do with the ball, if Max had it, he'd want to get the ball to the corner. So while that's happening, get the ball there, go back to your spot. So we can still do the exact same thing, and now the pass is just coming from starts in the corner. Boom, he goes around. Boom, gets the head around. Here he comes.
What does your passer do? What does the passer do?
Well, the passer, as soon as he passed the ball, what was the first option? He should have darted through it. He should have come in. So go back right again.
Run full speed now. Run full speed. Full speed. Hit the shooter up top. Let's go. Do it again. So timing's a lot of everything, right? So now you see the timing kind of starts making sense on this. Let's go. Hit the shooter. He leaves, everybody leaves, we come back, he's there, we're there. That's deep, Peter Krebs.
Now, one more thing, last thing, if I think about, whenever I think of plays, I always think about how I would defend it, and normally in a late game scenario, a lot of teams switch everything, which is, you know, not a bad idea, a lot of teams do that. So from there, go back, the last thing I would say about it is he would break to the corner, everything's the exact same, he'd come off, he'd pass the ball, he'd cut through. Now, right here, if they come set their screens, turn around, boom, you come up. Now, here's where the switch would happen. And then if I switch, what would Ryan Jett do? He can just slip all the way down, bump, yeah. And then there's your slip there. So I'd always think about, okay, at the end of the game, almost every team says, okay, we're going to switch every screen. Absolutely. So on that last option, so we're going to Ryan Jett and slip their lip and start.
Get all the options. Any questions with that? Cool. What's the other one?
The last one is going to be the one that goes in the flex. So if you're here, put that right here, 5 man would be here, boom, and you get to the corner, and you block. Yep. So now, from here, we just.
Stop. Where is everybody at? That's your point guard taking it out?
Kim, your point guard, I would like it to be your most athletic player. So your 3 man. Because why does a start just go there just for. Okay, just because he's going to be the one that's coming off the first flex screen, and you want your most athletic, best finisher to come off that flex screen for that layup. So you come down to the down screen, boom, you come up, as soon as he gets it outside the lane, you pass it in. On this catch, and you come up the floor time, yep, then you would turn right back around, and I'm going to set the pin down for Ryan. I mean, obviously in flex, you can just come up the floor and catch. As it's happening, he passes there. You need to go all the way out. Set your flex, first flex screen outside the 3-point line. Now you're on a dead sprint. Go into the left side. You should catch it.
Go back again. Let's go.
So they set down screen. Boom.
Catch it outside the 3, Brian. Justin, you will go on the other side of the screen. Do it again. Tom, you got to move quick. As soon as he's going, you're going. Brian, you got to catch the ball outside the 3. All right? Go. Move. Go, Tom. Go, Tom.
Boom, he come on, Ryan Jett passes it. So go back,
Go back and go slow. So the whole thing about any play coach is you want to have a lot of different options, right? Obviously, you just don't want to have this is our option and that's it, right? So now you got two options going on here. Go. Stop. So option one really is that screen right here with him coming off. Hey, man, if he can shoot, shoot the ball, right? Stay there. Option two is passing the ball here to Justin. If he can, if not, don't. He comes over to the block. That's fine. Option three, we're coming here. Stop. Catch the ball. Boom. Go off there. We are now floating to flex. So if nothing worked, it's all good. It didn't work. Boom. We flow right into the flex. Cool. Good enough. Baseline out of bounds. Pressure release.
This one, yeah, pressure release, but also this could be like a secondary out of all of your baseline out of bounds. Okay. So first thing, this is gonna be your best screener. So 5-man, 4-man, whatever's your best screener. You just take a step in, you pop out to the corner. He's gotta get into this man's body. You can't let him deny him like this. So if I'm guarding him like this, he's gotta get into me. Boom, he breaks out. He passes, he's gotta catch it outside the three. Man, as soon as he catches, you gotta do the same thing. Now you break to the 45. Boom, as that happens, you step in, you pass there. As soon as you catch, you come set it down screen. Boom, you set it up, you come off, catch and shoot. Outside three. So now, just like we said before, I mean, it's just principles coming off a down screen. If you tight trails, you can curl that. If he comes off, he goes up the three, you straight cut to the corner for a three. So let's just run.
So here's my point in that, coaches. If you've explained the screen properly and you've given it to him, then you can just put in the play, right? The problem that I see a lot of times, you put in the play, but then you're jumping up and down on the sideline like, you should have curled. You never explained the curl to him, though. You exposed them to it, but you never held them accountable to like, hey, they go your path, you curl the screen. Then it makes your life a lot easier right now on running this play because it's going to run itself at some point, right? Do it again. Let's go.
So also with that one, if you know, have a smarter team or just being more creative, it can be the exact same thing. You give him the ball, good, he pops out, boom. Now he steps in, he passes there. Now from here, he can make a decision, right? If he comes and sets a screen, or these two can come and set up a stagger on this side. Now Krebs can decide. He can say, okay, if I'm playing like this, then he wanna go off that screen. If I'm playing like this, I'm gonna walk this screen. How do you come off a double screen? All right, that's just all arena reacting. This isn't like, okay, you have to do this, you have to do this. This is just giving them more options so that they can read it and they can play. All right, so do the other one, you come off the standard, pick two. Good, step in, pass out. Good, yep, yep, step up. You guys are standard, good, yes, off it, two, pass out. Very good. Any questions there?
Questions there? We're good. Next one.
Ball out. Okay, same thing. You're gonna have a guard and a post player. I want this to be your best post finisher. All right, you need a guard opposite him, diagonal him on the elbow. As soon as the ball is put in, he slaps it over, you gotta break that way. Good, don't pass. You're gonna break up for pressure release in case we have nothing. All right, so as soon as he gets up, keep going, keep going. You're gonna turn, you're gonna set a diagonal screen, max. He's gonna set it up, he's always gonna go to the opposite block. Boom. The guy who's always gonna be open is the one who sets the screen. So as soon as he says it, and he sets it, he darts right back down to the block, boom, catch and shoot. So how it really is going to look, I'm gonna go back. If I'm guarding max, a lot of teams like to switch or they help off of a screen, which makes sense. So then as soon as they go, so Brian, he comes to set the screen, I'm helping out Max. As soon as you set the screen, you want to reverse, use my body, reverse thing, boom, you go right back to that. Okay, so let's run that full screen. Go, 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 go. And go, good, got it. Good, yes, that just really spaces the floor for your guard coming out for a layup and your best post finisher coming right back to the block for layup. Now, along with that, like I said, there could be a secondary off of that. Like we just ran that down screen to the corner, so we can do the exact same thing. If he's not open and he comes back down, what do? We pop out, Tom, you pop out, you go set it, boom, he comes off, he comes back down, he's not open. That's okay. Now we throw it out to Starks, boom, Tom would come over, because he was the pressure release, he'd step in, pass there, and then now here's the exact same thing. He can decide, does he want to come off the stagger screen, or he can come off the single screen this way. So there's your secondary sort of movement after your play doesn't work. Okay, so let's run that. Run the same exact thing all the way through. Now if Brian Jennings is open, throw it out to Starks. I come off a double screen in the corner and shoot. Go. Pops out, good. Drag the screen, come back to the ball. He's not open, so you get through it, catch and release. Good job. Now you come into the screen, boom, catch and shoot. Any questions there? Here's the secondary, it doesn't work.
Do we need to see that again, or we're good? You're good? We're good? Cool. You said one more time? One more time.
Okay. Yep, so now go off the other way, go off the single screen. All right, Tom, you've got to improve your passing, so take a dribble over. Take a dribble over to improve your passing. Good, good, good. Take a dribble over. Now, also, there's, you know, teams that are, you know, pressure more on defense, you know, and based on the bounds, that's fine. If they pressure Starks in the corner, that's okay. That's why Tom's a pressure release. He's got to get out, and we can just skip everything, throw it out to him, boom, it's the exact same thing. Now we're in, he comes down, he chooses whatever side. So we just skip that first pass if things are not in.
That makes sense? Right on.
Last one. So then this one will flow right into your flex movement. I need. Best shooter right here. Starks there. Good. The Max coming out. Nope. Brian Jett right there. Here. So we got a four low set from here. All right. This is a very important concept that a lot of people, a lot of coaches, a lot of teams don't understand. Right now, he's going to post up. So if you're on him, he's going to try and post up. He's going to post up with his arm out here. What's going to happen is, when the ball is handed in to Krebs, he's going to throw it over Brian Jett's head. Okay? No, you got to throw it all the way to the elbow. Don't throw it yet. Okay? Brian Jett's not allowed to leave until the ball gets over his head. Because if he leaves early, then I can use my body to get into him and be able to steal this pass. If he waits and holds me in a post up until the ball gets over his head, boom, throws it. Nope. You can't leave early. You have to wait until the ball gets over your head. You'll get there. Go to the elbow. Okay? Stop. Go back. Slow down. Okay? So right now, he's not posting me up. So he's got to get all the way into me as hard as he can, because I don't want him to catch the ball right here. Okay? So I'm going to be denying here. He posts me up really hard. Boom. Now he goes over his head. Very good. That would be perfect. Okay? So now from there, I can run and take the pass. If a team scouts you and says, okay, I know they're going to run this play with a throw over his head, and I do something like this, I mean, that's just easy. Okay, so now from here, do the same thing, throws it over his head, boom, catches it, very good. Now, Max is going to dart up, same thing, he steps in, pass across, now we're right into our flex move, he comes off, here's your best finisher, going across the block, going, there's your down screen for your catch and shoot. Okay, another thing that we did a lot, or that I've seen a lot, is that if this is your best post finisher, post player, and you don't have a very good shooter, that's okay. Go back, run again. Catch the ball, go, and don't shoot. Okay, pass out. Good, catches. Good, reverse it. Good, yes. Now, right here, stop. So he would want to come down here, yep, to set this screen. Boom, he comes off. Boom, on the catch. Pass. Right here is where Brian would want to take his hand down. We call it reverse it, it's sealed. Boom. Here for a one-on-one push. As soon as you catch, you gotta improve your passing game, though, because I know you know how to pass into the post. Yes. Okay, so that's going to the post. So this would mean if you don't have a very good shooter, that's okay. Now you gotta find out which pieces in your team match. Okay, he sets it down screen, boom, you want to reverse the seal. Now you gotta post up for your best post. Go. Good. Well, good, set it. Good. Good ball. Good seal. Good. questions on that one? So then that one could just flow right into your flex. He sets the down screen versus ball.
One more time.
He goes and sets his back.
One more time.
All right, so let's break this down. So he's got to post up, right? He has to. Okay, that's the only way the pass over the top is going to work. All right, so we got to be able to throw that ball. Now, here's what's important. Take the ball back out. All right, again, it's spacing out of bounds. We don't want Peter to catch the ball with his feet on the out of bounds line. We want him to have some spacing, okay? Generally, the person guarding Peter is not going to be in his face. They're going to push him over to be where Gallo is right there. All right, that's usually how people are going to play it defensively. So now, once he does that, the ball's over his head. You got to hold him accountable to that, coach. He catches, okay? He's going to step in. He's going to lift, pass the ball. We end up being in the flex. Easy enough. We set the screen. We're going to set that. Now, it's coming off here, okay? Brian would walk his man in. At this point, Peter proves his angle, and then he reverse spins, and he's open. Cool? Cool with that. Good there. So those are three slobs, three blobs. Yes? Sideline, out of bounds, baseline, out of bounds, right? Slob and blob. What questions do you have that you want me to go over with? No, in general. I'm going to give you basic ball screen principles because at the older levels, you guys are running ball screens. Yes? Some? Okay. All right. This is just very basic, generic ball screen principles, okay? Max takes the ball. Justin, set the screen. You're setting the ball screen. Peter off. Ball screen the other way. All right. If we're setting the ball screen on the 45, okay? For one, we need to set it on the 45, all right? You will most likely try to have this foot either, you're gonna have them straddle the three, or you want foot above, okay? The ball screen involves a bunch of patience, okay? In a situation where it's off of the jab, meaning you just caught the ball, all right? Or in any situation, really, he's gonna have to give some sort of fake baseline. Sometimes the fake is just to run off the ball screen. But the reason you want to give some little kind of fake, a little inside out, a little jab, is because he'd rather play defense on him. He'd rather take on one defender instead of two, right? Because when it's a ball screen situation, okay, defensively, I'm going to push towards help, right? I'm not going to keep on playing defense like this because I have no help, right? It doesn't really make sense. So I would sit there and guard him like this. He wants to at least make me think he's going to go this way, right? So a little jab or something, fine. He does that and then he's changing. Okay, now when he's going off the ball screen, again, it's just like coming off a screen, he's got to go shoulder to shoulder, okay? What we teach our players and what they teach you at all levels, if you take one dribble off the ball screen, you better shoot it or pass it, all right? Because if you take one dribble and pick it up, you killed the ball screen, all right? A very American philosophy of ball screen is all we teach is that person coming off, it's for you to shoot, you to shoot, you to shoot. That's all we think about. I'm getting off the screen, I'm letting it go. That is not what a ball screen is for. A ball screen is for just to create an advantage, all right? Sometimes the advantage is for you to shoot. Other times it is just for you to stretch the floor and pass to the pass, all right? So that's what you have to start telling your players, hey, you're coming off the ball screen to find the advantage. If you got the advantage, shoot it. If you don't force it. You probably missed something else that was going on. Okay, so if we were coming off one dribble, hey, he might end up rolling and we end up going pocket pass. All good. Okay, go back. Let's go. Hurry up. If we're coming off one dribble, he might come off and go for a shot, right? One, and we can pull. Okay, most of the time off ball screens, you're probably going to stretch it out two dribbles. Okay, from there, honestly, it depends where your offense is and where you're set on what you're doing. Okay, what I mean by that is go to the corner. Give me three blacks, guard them. Guard these three. Actually, one step off. Gallo, would you guard that? One of you step off. Trent, step off. Okay, you're fine. Trent, stay on. I don't care. Somebody step off. Boom, we're good. All right, ball screen is all predicated on how the defender's playing the ball screen, right? That's going to tell you what the offense does. That's what tells you what everybody does, okay? In a situation where you have overloaded one side. This is an overload. We got three people on one side, right? We got two on the other side, okay? This is not his time to probably turn the corner. This is not what he should be thinking as a ball screen, all right? He needs to be thinking shooter or post, because this is what ends up happening. Now, let's just say Liam's going to try to play it over the top. Gallo's just going to be in a little show and recover, and we're getting back, okay? We're going to go very slow on this. Very, very, very slow. Stay deep in the corner. You will notice one thing out of all of this, coaches. Whenever we're explaining sideline out of bounds, baseline out of bounds, their natural tendency is always to walk here. My kids, right? Everybody wants to walk here. Tell them to play basketball outside the three-point line. Space the court. They never want to do it. They always want to come in, right? Space the court and stand where I'm telling you to, because it's all about spacing. Now, when he comes off this ball screen, okay? Now, at this moment, Justin's going to roll. Who's the only person who can help out on the roll? It would have to be him, right? He's going to just supply a little bit of help, okay? He's got to take two dribbles. He can't take one. He's got to stretch it because that's going to occupy Gallo, okay? Now, he will end up lifting, and you will stretch it another dribble because you'll stretch it, and then you'll throw it back. That's your open shot. Go do that again. That's why he's got to take two dribbles off the ball screen. He's got to stretch the floor, okay? Back up. So he's coming off of this. Boom, he takes two off. Justin rolls. He gets there. There's your open shot, okay? Now, if we go back and he's not open off the ball screen, okay? I'm sorry, he's not open for the shot. They played really good defense. All right, it's totally fine. He's coming off of this. You're running off. Stretch it, two, stretch it, stretch it, stretch it, stretch it. Yes, stretch it. Good. Now, you pass it back. Here's where you're in good hands because we're here. This is your post player. All he's going to do is do this because he's running top side. Stay there and get in the post feet. He's running top side to his shoulder. Now you got a two-man game and you're all good. Go back and do that again. Do that again. He's coming off. He stretches it. He rolls. He catches up top. Boom. He's going to meet him there. Life is good. So it really just depends on how people are, where your offense is, on what you're going to do off a ball screen. But just generically speaking, your person's going to have to take two dribbles off the ball screen and then read. It might be a pass over the top. It might be a shot. If it's one pass and pick up, your ball screen's dead. So they have to take two and stretch the court. Okay, but everything's predicated on how that big is guarding you. If they're in a soft hedge, strong, show and recover, trap, switch, whatever they're doing, that's going to change on what the ball handler's going to do off the ball screen. But generically speaking, they need to have some little fake baseline, so they only take one defender on. They got to go shoulder to shoulder off of it, and they really need to stretch the defense and then find the advantage. Does that answer that really with the ball screen? Ooh. You want me to get that deep? Okay, here we go. Now here we go. Let's go. We're going deep. Here we go. I'm going to break it down for you. Let's go. You over there. All right. I want you back over here. Yes. Defense, get off. Okay. Gallo, when you be the post? Opposite post. Yeah, on offense. So if we're in that situation, we got a two-man game. Okay? Two-man game. Yeah, it depends, right? So if we're coming off here, boom, he's coming off the ball screen, right? A lot of times we got two-man game. Yes, this is a time where he can turn, okay? Because, again, if Gallo was where he was, he would keep on turning the corner, Max, and then he would back off, okay? Then he would be there. So he could turn the corner on that one, or he could come off and shoot, all right? If it's overloaded on one side like we just did, it's probably not the time to turn the corner, okay? Now, if you end up having post high, right, and you have this situation, which you totally can. He is not trying to turn the corner on this. All he's trying to do is get the ball to him real quick so he can get the ball to him real quick, and then we can shoot the ball. I hope this is not going too far over everybody's head. All right, here's the whole thing about pick and roll basketball, okay? Personal story, I was in Germany. I thought I was great. I just came out of England. I got MVP. We won the championship. Life was good. I got to Bosnia, top 10 leagues in the world, and I got cut in 30 days because I didn't understand ball screen. Right now, I was 25, okay, but it was top league and top 10 leagues, right? All those Yugo players, they're all coming out of the Adriatic League. I got cut because I didn't understand ball screen, because I thought every time it was for me to come off and shoot, and it wasn't. It was supposed to be an advantage. I got sent to the third league in Germany, met a coach who broke it down to me, and then I tripled my paycheck for the next 3 years just because I understood ball screen, all right? I will say this, we have a whole thing in America that it's really this rite of passage thing. Like at some point where you think that your player's ready to learn this. They start doing pick and roll over in Europe in fourth grade. They start just coming off ball screens in fourth grade. So what I want you guys to really let go of is, my kids aren't good enough to do that. Well, No, duh, because you never taught them. Like, if you start to introduce it to them a little bit, then they will get ready to learn it. Okay? So just basically, if you were just doing some ball screen stuff, if it was just two man and you were just doing some drilling, he'd come set the screen. You tell him to jab, starting triple threat. We tell him to jab. I want you to run off to a hezo, two dribbles, and shoot the ball. Right? Set the screen. Boom. Jab. Hezo. Two dribbles. Shoot the ball. Right? And you could just rep that out. That's as much as we need. Right? Then if you do what I'm telling you, and hey, you had maybe wife, assistant coach, somebody maybe film it. One day for 20 minutes, we plug it into USB on the computer, and you say, hey, John, did you see Tom open? All right, now we're going to come off and work on that pass. Now we're building. Okay, but it is going to take some effort, coaches, to really get them to understand the concepts that you're trying to teach. But if we just start basic, understand the screen, understand how to move without the ball, cool enough. All right, then we start to build from there. You're good, because any type of ball screen is going to end up being driving kick, right? Because he turned the corner, he's got to lift because he's got to stay in his ball handler's vision. But they know that because of driving kick moving out the ball. Does that make sense? Is there anything, because I don't want to make this all about this if we need some help in here. So is there something else with that we can break down that we can make a little bit easier for you to see? Drills, team concepts, anything? Any questions at all? Coaches, you're breaking the rules. We're supposed to ask a question. We're supposed to learn.
The help side of defense. If you could just touch that, you might have. I know we passed defense on my mid to.
It's fine. Give me five red, and give me everybody else on defense that's in black. Coach Gallo, if you could play defense, please. All right, let's go in a real live situation. Would you want three out, two in, five out? What do you want?
Yeah.
Three out, two in, or five out?
Five
out, cool. Red, you're five out, okay? So generically, this is where we're gonna start. With help defense, really what you wanna understand is if you're one pass away or two passes away. That's gonna really predicate your stance, okay? One pass away, you need to be playing passing lanes, okay? But Gallo, Silva, they are two passes away now, okay? They are not gonna play over there. Because if they do, we just opened up, hey, let's just go run to the rim. There's no help side at all, right? So they are always going to be, if you're two passes away, you're always going to be in a shallow triangle, okay? If you can see this triangle from the ball to Coach Gallo to Max, from Max to the ball is a triangle. Here's a triangle right here as well, from here to here to here. That's how you always know if your player's in the correct position, because if they get to here, now we're not on a triangle, that's how you get backdoored, that's how you get killed. Right? So we always have to be in a shallow triangle. We don't need to be in the big triangle. One pass away, that doesn't make sense because he's going to shoot the ball. Right? So shallow triangle every single time. All right? This is a basic kind of five-man shell. So if the pass goes here, all right, now everybody's got to jump to the ball. That's the term that you use, jump to the ball. All right? It's very simple. Jump to the ball. Like where the ball's at, jump to it. Okay? Because the first thing that we have to do is defend the basketball. All right, that's the person that has the most valuable thing on the court. That's the thing that you have to defend. All right, that's going to tell you everything about everything. We got to see both, so we tell them pull the guns out, right? Point to man, point to ball. All right, so right now, Trent, Silva, Liam would be just like this, point all. Everybody's in a shallow triangle right now, okay? Help side, I'll even go seventh grade and under. Go ahead and teach them to be on the real helpline that we all know. That's totally fine, all good. Okay, because you just don't have kids that are strong enough to throw a skip pass at that point. As we start to get, you know, a little bit more better seventh and some eighth, we'll start teaching helpline right over here because he's bigger. He's just physically bigger, so he can go get there in that gap and cut it off, but he can also get to the shooter because we can have somebody who can throw a skip pass at that age. So that's why we have a difference on how we'll start to teach and evolve it. Okay, but generically, this will be their helpline. Everybody's seeing it. Okay, now if we end up getting here and we end up throwing it there, he is in a closeout situation. Here's what I'm going to tell you, coaches. Force baseline, force weak hand, force help. You make the decision. Okay, what I'm saying is if he has the basketball right here, take the ball, please, Tom, please. What I'm saying is the stance right now on the ball that Justin has. Okay. I'm sure we all kind of came up under force baseline, right? But if some of us were Indiana fans and Bobby Knight said, force help, there's no wrong answer on that. I mean, that's really honestly up to you, okay? Now, some of us, what I'm gonna teach as they start to get older is force weak hand. So I don't care what side are you on, if they're right-handed, force him left every single time, because I'm gonna dare him to kill us left-handed. I think he can take one dribble left, and I think he's gonna pick the ball up. I don't think he's gonna be able to take two dribbles left through contact and be able to finish. So I'm gonna make him force weak. But whether you force base, force to help, or force weak, honestly, that's up to you. That's your philosophy. That's your kind of autonomy as a coach that you can decide what you want to do in those situations, okay? So if the ball ends up going there, the main thing that we need to teach when we're talking about shell is you see Coach Gallo moving as if he's still in college or playing professionally, because that's what you get used to. You have to move while the ball's in the air. Right, our kids are gonna move too slow because they're gonna do this, they catch, then they're gonna move. It's too slow. Somebody already drove and hit that gap. You have to move while the ball moves in the air. All right, so what we'll try to get them to is being there on the catch. And on the catch does not mean fixing your shorts. That's one of my pet peeves that I kill them on every single time. You don't get there on your defender and then do this. What are we doing? Like, you have to already have your hands ready to play basketball, right? So fix your shorts and get there quicker. Figure it out. But you can't fix your shorts and play defense, okay? So they just need to be there on the catch, all right? And they need to be in the proper position. Now, it's going to end up coming to if he goes and down screens for Max and we're playing up and through. Stop. What are you going to look at? Exactly. Thank you. So then you would back off and we're playing up and through, and then life is good. It's gonna segment off. So again, if you teach them kind of just how to guard a screen, then you can take that into shell, then you can take that into live shell, okay? What I'm just really trying to guard against with everybody is starting on shell, and they have no clue and trying to clean it up this way. It's gonna be too much for them, all right? You're gonna have to lower that down. And I'm telling you that as a person who's trained the national ranked players in fourth and fifth and sixth grade, if you get into that crap, I trained them all. Chase Adams, Kizo, all those kids that are all this, when they were going into freshman year and had scholarship offers, I had them when they were in fourth grade too, all right? It was still too much for them, and they were prodigies, right? You're gonna have to slow it down and really explain it to them. If you start this much, this starts to be a little bit too much. Explain how to guard a screen up and through. Now all of a sudden we get in the shell, ball's over there, he's gonna go down, Gallo's gonna guard it correctly, he's gonna tell him to come through, we're good, right? We'll blast Justin because he should still be on the helpline. That's how we end up doing it with help defense. Okay, if we're in gaps, put the ball back up here with Peter, please. If Peter were to drive right, all right, stop. This is what you got to guard against too, coaches. You have to tell your players, show and recover. We say hip and hand, all right, hip and hand. All we want is Justin's hip and his hand to be providing help. We don't want him to show Peter his numbers. All right, if he shows him his numbers, now we have an open shot. Now Gallo has to close out. Now we got a one more situation. Now we're done, right? So when you're playing help defense, you're telling your players hip and hand, hip and hand, hip and hand, okay? Hip and hand, you're just kind of doing this, providing some help. Don't just run over to the ball because you think your teammate was beat because the person's dribbling. They're not, okay? If they're still on their shoulder, we're there. Now, if we're back here and Liam, he hits you with an unbelievable jab and you are beat, get off the way, boom, and he drives that way. Yes, now Trent, go Peter. Trent is gonna have to go stop the ball at this point, right? This is not time for hip and hand. This is time to go stop the basketball. Your person's out of there, mayday, mayday. We need some help, right? So we have to really show them your numbers and we're just gonna have to scramble out of that. All right, that will start to get in the third man rotation, help the helper. We're not gonna get that far today, all right? But that's what that ends up turning into, how to help the helper, okay? Does that make sense with the help side? Question. Don't break the rules, coaches. Yes, sir.
How deep does the bottom help side get? Ever below the basket or always?
If the ball's right in the corner, absolutely. You still got to be on a shallow triangle, okay? You still got to be on a shallow. What you want to avoid at all costs defensively, and this is why you have to jump to the ball. And again, it's a chess match, so we're going to teach offense, defense. Put the ball here, okay? On the ball, if the pass is here. If Liam does not jump, you want to avoid this, which is a face cut, right? So when somebody tries to run, now that's an example of a face cut, but what ends up happening a lot of times, coaches, is it will be Brian who's just gonna run right in front of Trent's face, run right in front of Trent. You don't want that to happen, right? That's that face cut thing, that UCLA cut, that basket cut. It's because the defense didn't jump to the ball. All right, so defensively, you want to teach them, hey, just jump to the ball. So if they cut, they run into your chest. All right, if not, teach your offense, hey, they're not jumping to the ball. Fake and just face cut them every single time. You're going to be wide open for layup after layup after layup after layup. Does that answer that? Yes, sir. Sure. Do you want to take that? 2-3 zone offense. Black plate defense.
I'll stand there. I can stand there because you just played the offense. I'll be the last defender. Yeah, okay.
You can. Guard is basketball.
Red right.
I need both 45. Yep. Time. I'm going on the block.
So that's a 2-3.
This is a 2-3. Okay. Normally, when you have good shooters, you want to tell them to split the difference between this guy and the bottom guy. Because what will happen in the 2-3 is as that pass goes, okay, if he splits the difference between the two, now these two have to talk. Does he close out or does he close out? All right, in a perfect 2-3 world, normally he would guard, starts to guard the ball, Krebs had the ball, boom, and on the pass, Coach Matt would have to help for a second. Now Starks would have to pull over, and then he'd be able to back up. That's kind of a perfect 2-3 rule. So if you split the difference, now you get them thinking, do I help, do I not help, do I show, do I not show?
That's called a bump and recover, right? He's got to bump me off. Do that again, because that's what they'll teach you on defensively and what you want. Go. Pass the ball there. Pass the ball there. So I'm here. He's going. Pass the ball there. I'd say, let's go, Justin. Give me Justin. Give me Justin. Bump. And then I'm here. Bump and recover, right? Put me in a bump and recover situation is what we're saying, because they're not going to be able to do it, right? Go again from there.
Tom, yep, now Tom can face up, now Tom can go here, take a shot, take a dribble, and now we got to go there. Absolutely. If we can get the ball to the middle, then that's glorious. That's what we want in offense. Now, good defense team. Here we want to take this away. Absolutely. Now, from here, zone the ball. Another really important thing against zone defense is you want to use the short corner. So, with Max, who's going to be here on the block, he just want to take 2 or 3 steps out here, okay? And if you can ever get the ball to the short corner against the zone, you want to do it, okay? So if he passes here to the short corner, and here comes Coach Matt to help. From here, once the ball goes to the short corner, Tom needs to dive to the rim. Yep. And so now look at Liam Kim. Liam Kim has to decide, does he want to help here? Does he want to stay on Brian Jett? Or if he bounces off, stays on Brian Jett. Now here comes Trent Warren. Now Max can square up, and then he can look for a skip back. Boom. All right, so you always want to try and get the ball to the short corner. Okay, if that's not open, everything's fine. They reverse the ball, get it back out. Boom, get it back out. Good, to the top. Now Tom, I'm going to go back to the spot. Good, reverse the ball. Absolutely, not from here. See, so Silva's not helping. So he feels the difference. Now we're fine there. Okay, you can catch and shoot. I catch and shoot. Okay, Tom, we want to come out to the short corner. Yup, Max is already in the high post. We can go to the short corner, do it. Here comes Max's cut to the rim. Boom, he's not open, whatever, skips it out. Good, reverse the ball. Good, Otsugai always comes up to the high post. Now you decide from there. Right, it's always a numbers game. You want to occupy or overload a side with 3 people. All right, does that make sense? Does anyone have any questions on that? Normally you're going to get the ball at the high post or the short corner. We did it, we would say, you know, we want to get to the short corner multiple times because it's just so hard to guard the short corner and then skipping the ball out and getting the zone moving. Once the zone's moving, then offense is at the advantage. That's really what you want.
You want to see a different breakdown of any zone?
Well,
for the offensive standpoint. Gotcha. Defense getting a 1-3-1. Yeah, you can go for it, sure. Sorry, we like to take turns on doing this stuff. The whole thing, coaches, to think about is attack even front with odds, attack odd front with evens. So kind of basic, generic kind of zone principle, right? So we got a 1-3-1, so we want to attack it with evens, meaning we want two, right? We had a 2-3, we attacked it with odds, right? We had three, okay? Just kind of basic zone kind of stuff. I'm defense.
So like you said, we want to attack with an even front versus an odd man front. So now, if he's pressuring the ball here, that's fine. You can't throw the ball on top. You got to improve the passing angle. You got to pass the ball. Now from here, a good 1-3-1, okay? Offense is always seeing diagonal passing. So right now, Max is in the corner, but you almost want to think, okay, from here, if Coach Matt doesn't dive in to guard the block, then Max should just be coming to the rim. And we should always try and look diagonals. Like that. Absolutely. Stop. Trent, that doesn't make sense. I'll take the ball here. So a good 1-3-1, we'd have the ball starts, we're going to come and pressure the ball. The guy in the bottom would always take strong side corner. So Trent, we'd not stand him if he guarded strong side corner every single time. Okay, so he guards strong side corner. Now Coach Matt has to decide, does he take away the basket for a layup, or does he take away that skip to Silva? Okay, now let's say a good 1-3-1 defense, he would definitely not give up a layup. Okay, perfect. So then Tom, take one dribble, whatever, improve the passing angle. Boom, now the guy decides. Now Max is going to go all the way out. Yup, and now Trent is going to use the diagonal passing, all right, to be able to make this for a layup. Now Sarge sets the side. Do I give up a layup, or do I give up a skip? Obviously, you want to give up a skip. So right now, Coach Matt, we're going to take the ball. Trent Warren always guards the ball side corner. Boom, from there. So the big thing with 1-3-1 is you always want to look diagonal. Pass fakes, and diagonal passing is the most important against a 1-3-1.
Cool, there. With a zone, how fast do we move the ball?
How fast do we hold on to the ball?
Do we hold on to the ball? You don't. I mean, it's 1 second.
So that's going to kill your zones, okay? Offensively, if your players hold the ball and try to read, you're done, right? You're going to have to tell them, look, get the ball out your hands. So you have to really show them where to go and how to move. Get the ball out your hands, All right, you want to kill it on a pass, but there is a philosophy in basketball that you got to drive a gap and make one guard two, right? Just same thing if we were doing a diamond press. I want my point guard to occupy two people and then release, and then we're good on the opposite side, right? Because we have a numbers advantage again. Okay, so eventually you can't just always pass it around the horn. You should pass it to the point that you put people in closeout situations. Somebody can hit a gap. Somebody can move without the ball, but now we're back to moving without the ball principles. Okay, so it can't just be passing all around. At some point, you should have been moving the ball quick enough where I'm running out on him. He can just hit a gap. Now we're in a drive and kick situation. We got a shot right there. Okay, yes. No, absolutely not. Go for it.
What I would say is normally with fourth graders, you obviously wouldn't want to be this wide. Like when I was even in high school, we were starting it from about here. Okay. And if they want to pressure, super high, that's fine. If one kid wants to pressure, he's got to be all the way out here. Obviously, you're not going to make the diagonal pass from here. But what's going to happen is he's going to reverse the ball to there. So then now he's closer to the basket to be able to make this diagonal pass.
Okay,
and now, like Coach Matt said, you really want to have two guys occupy one. So right now, we're in a good scenario because two guys are trying to guard one. You should be out there. Trent could be guarding him. Yep. And then now from here, you want to just throw it the easiest next pass.
Stop.
Now you got to find your closeout situation.
So now I'm in a closeout, right? So now drive the ball. And now we're forcing Trent to have to go guard all the way over there and help him go. Okay? So at that age level, yeah, it's going to be a lot of passing quick, and then somebody's going to have to be able to take 1-2 dribbles in, okay, and then just make the right pass. That would be a better situation at that age level. Anybody else with some questions on that? Are you guys good on pressing? Or do you need anything with that? For what kind of defense? Well, let's just go over it all right? If we're in a man situation, Max, take the ball out. Everybody else, get off the court. Gallo's guarding me. Justin guard the ball, let's just say. Everybody else just move. All right, so he's guarding me, and oh, it's a man-to-man. All right, first of all, always tell your people to start here, okay? Because it just gives you more equity in the court, all right? Even the ball goes out, and hey, we can outlet it quick, cool, but then we wouldn't have a press, all right? But if it's in one, we're out of timeout, dead ball, hey, man, we're gonna start here. You have to have one person who can beat him, okay? Figure out how to get open, whatever it is, get open. If you have to end up having another person up here, it's all good, doesn't matter. We would just end up running into setting a screen here, and it's kind of like the baseline out of bounds. I'd go this way, he'd roll back to the ball that way. You could stack them at the top, same thing, all right? But at the whole situation where we end up talking about a man press and I got the ball, I'm catching the ball here, and I'm saying, Max, leave, get out the way. Hurry up and take Justin with you. I got to be able to get the ball up the court. That's why we do one-on-one zigzag. Right, I got to be able to get the ball up the court one-on-one. One-on-one in basketball is an advantage. That is a numbers advantage in basketball, believe it or not. You have to be good enough to beat one person, okay? Beating two, now we're at a disadvantage, but you got to be good enough to beat one person. Now, if we get into a zone situation, let's go a diamond, I guess. Diamond is good enough. So red, you'll be on offense. Black will take defense. I will take the top of a diamond. Two and two. Well, we go one, two, two, one. I mean, what do you want them doing? That's a one, two, two, actually. Sorry, one there and then one back. Stop, go back there first. So technically, defensively, this is a diamond, right? Okay, diamond press. Coach Gallo's telling him to go this way and guard him, the backside of the diamond, because he has to because the ball's on this side of the court. Right, so you still have to. Any zone is still gonna go into some type of man principles, right? And we got a man up, he's gotta guard that side, otherwise we get the ball there, we're done, okay?
Good, so now from here, because it's a odd man front, you wanna counter the even man front. So from here, these guys would just pick one side, whatever some guy decides. Now, the big thing you don't wanna do is you don't want your point guard or your guard to catch the ball so deep into the baseline. Because when that happens and they don't have room, and the big thing that we teach our guards against traps is to really use a retreat dribble. Okay, you gotta be able to use a retreat dribble to create space. So Brian, recall the ball right there, that's way too deep in the baseline. Because if he wants to do a retreat dribble, he can't do it. So the big thing you wanna do is if you can catch the ball right here, or even right here, or even right here, now I have room to really be able to retreat when there's a trap that comes. Okay, so now from here, let's just say, you know, they do the same thing, they break it out. Boom, they get it into Brian, pass it to Brian. Now, diamonds normally would run and trap, absolutely. So as soon as they trap, Max has to step in and get in the play, okay? Be a reversal pass, okay? So right now, they're running a trap, so now Starks has to guard two, he's gotta decide, okay? Normally, a good trapping team would wanna take away the next pass. Boom, that's fine, okay? If he does that, Tom, because he's diagonal, will come racing through the middle with his hands up, trying to get the basket. Okay, if he can get it there, that's what we want. He throws it to the middle. Middle kills any kind of zone, any kind of trap. Throw it to the middle. Boom, square up. Always want to square up. Now we got him racing. There we go. Big thing here, all right? What Tom's doing. Once we got the ball to Krebs, Tom's job isn't over. He doesn't pass, and now Krebs is fine. Okay, because if Krebs goes, now Liam Kitchen will stop. Wait, too far. All right, come back, give it to Tom in the middle. Give it to Tom in the middle. Okay, he caught, he squared up. Liam Kim took him for a second. Now Tom throws that pass. Liam Kim, what do you do? He's gonna run and take the ball. So now if he keeps running, now it's just a two-on-two situation. We want Tom to keep going so that we can continue to have our three-on-two. Boom, now we're going to two-on-two. So the play's never really over for you in the middle. All right, we say get it to the middle, go to the sideline, and you want to keep going up the floor. You never want to just leave your teammates out to join. And that's a big thing that I see at the high school level. This guy's getting in the middle, he reverses it out, now we're off to the races, and this guy stands. Then it's 2-on-2, we kind of really lose our game. Okay, we'll go back to that again.
Here's the thing you guys got to teach your players, and there's no play that's going to, you're just going to have to teach them this. You got to run to the open space, and you have to want the ball. We can give you any type of situation, but in that same situation, if he comes here, and this is what happens a lot, right? And we pass the ball here, and then Liam's kind of playing middle, you're over there playing that, stop. He's just gonna kind of run and hide behind Liam, because he really doesn't want the ball. Because it's a pressure situation and the kids are scared. So they never really run to get the basketball. They never really run to the open spot. They just kind of run and hide. You're going to have to teach your players to want the ball. Okay, they're going to have to want it, because any type of situation we're going to give you, if they don't want the basketball and they just kind of run behind the defender, it's never going to work. Okay, if we get the ball back here, boom.
Now from here, you obviously want to give it to the other side so you can just stretch out the defense more. So Starks would take here, these guys are scrambling, you would almost try to trap, but really know you won't be able to reverse it right away. Boom, now we want to attack it before we want to go. Now from here, stop, boom. Okay, from here, just like when the ball was there on that side, Tom came in through the middle. If the ball is on this side, now I want Silva to come in the middle to be able to allow us to have that pass. Now it's supposed to go, so there goes Brian Jett, boom, he passes. Now the other Silva goes guard, now he's gonna keep coming up the floor to our 3-on-2. Does that make sense? Any questions there? So wherever the ball, whatever side the ball is on, opposite guy, diagonal's gotta flash to the middle. Always wanna flash to the middle.
Make sense? Anything else? Any other questions? Gentlemen, I appreciate that. Thank you very much. You guys are good. You can get your basketballs, please, and I'm going to wrap things up. Thank you, guys. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Very good job, gentlemen. Thank you. I appreciate it. So, hold the balls. Coach's Corner is online. It's for you. Okay, it breaks down some of these things that we're doing. Some of the stuff we talked about today, give me 3 weeks and it'll be up there as well. So when we're drilling with your players and you see us on Friday nights that we're doing it, I think we switch to Wednesdays, some when we get into November, okay? We'll be anywhere on that tutorial, all right? We've got some teams that were kind of the same team as last year that have come in. So they've gone through our kind of our basic gamut of skill work. We're gonna start getting into coming off of screens, moving without the ball. All right, teams that kind of just started, we're gonna get them their basic skill set first, okay? And then kind of walk them up the ladder. All right, again, we don't hold anybody back ever, but we don't ever move too fast either. All right, and that's something that kind of frustrates some parents, and some parents don't get frustrated by it, but I'm just not gonna move too fast for your kid. Like, and you're not gonna be the one to tell me that your kid has it. Because again, when I put a defender in front of them, that's gonna let me know if they got it. We have a law at M14. Oh, I wanna move up classes. 20 and you're out. 20 one-on-ones, straight, you're out. Go to the next class. There's no point for you to be here. But you're gonna show that to us, right? So you have to let your player show you what they have, all right? And then just adjust your plans off of that and then continue to help them. But again, set some goals, coaches. All right, set some goals individually, set some goals for your teams, and then communicate those to the parents, and then they will start to see those as how we deem this as a successful season or not. Because if it's just wins or losses, then it ends up being, well, they went to this place. So that, who cares, man? Like, we got them to set screens. We got them to use the screen. We got them to curl. We got them to use a left-hand layup. We got them to do those things. This is a win. All right, I do remember, and I'm 33. I remember third grade. We won one game for Wheatland. All right, we won one game, all right? It was fun, though. We still learned some stuff because back then it wasn't just as much pressure on having to do it now. Our entire practice was layups, and that was exciting. But this was also like 91, all right? So just kind of harness all that and kind of blend it in, right? Keep it exciting, keep it fun, keep it competition, but still make sure we're still obtaining some goals while we're doing it. Cool. Any questions? Again, I will not hold you. 60 seconds off, but we're all good. I appreciate you guys coming out today. Thank you very much. Thank you. We're good.